Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious.
In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, the chief guest of the evening, Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, Dr. Zakir Naik, Mr. Chamanbhai Vora, Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum. May peace be on you. On behalf of the organizers, the Indian Vegetarian Congress, the Islamic Research Foundation, and the Rushaf Foundation, I welcome all of you today to this morning's unique program, a public dialogue on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? It is being held in a spirit of friendship and understanding each other's viewpoints. I, Dr. Muhammad Naik, am the coordinator for this dialogue. Hence, I occupy a neutral position. It is my onerous duty to ensure a fair and proper conduct of this meeting. Therefore, I would request both our speakers as well as the audience to maintain due decorum for a healthy and lively debate, as well as a dialogue. Now we would have the past president of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, Mr. Jayantilal R. Doshi, welcoming and introducing the chief guest of the evening, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi. Mr. Jayantilal Doshi.
Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, he is a very senior advocate in the Supreme Court of India and leading tax expert of Mumbai. His activity in economics field inside ex-president of Indian Mercantile Chambers and active members of chairman of many other institute, trade and industrial body. In professional field, he was president of Chambers of IT Consultant and Vice President of IT Tribunal and Bar Association. In political field, he is traders of Maha Pradesh Congress Committee, BRSCC. He is also chairman and director of many public limited company, Reliance and Dana Bank. In education field, he was location of Master's degree in lower and Bombay University. He regularly continues article of various submitted in different papers and journalists. He has addressed a member of senior and meeting of Rotary, Lions Club, etc. and Air India and Doordarshan, etc. Thank you.
Now we have Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, President of the Rushaf Foundation, presenting mementos to our chief guest, as well as garlanding him on behalf of the organizers. Now we have our chief guest, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, addressing our audience collected here today. Mr. Y.P. Trivedi.
Dr. Zakir Naik, Mr. Rashmibhai, Dr. Mohammad Naik, Dr. Dhanraj Salecha, Chimanlal Vora, and friends. Before I give my introductory speech, I have been told and I think I would like to repeat and say with great firmness that one of the greatest friend and the greatest enemy of our civilization is the cellular phone. And all those who have got cellular phones, it's a great friend, you know, when you are in absolute necessity and when you are in a meeting, it's a great enemy. So I would request all those with cellular phones, please switch off the phone and do not disturb, because it disturbs the train of thinking of those who are speaking, on those who are attending and are listening very attentively. Friends, I welcome all the speakers and all of you here to this very healthy debate which is taking place. I believe that this should be the beginning of similar debates which should take place in the times to come. This debate or discussion or the clearing house of mind is probably in the best traditions, both of the Hindu civilization as well as of Islam. In our mythology and our history, we have such instances of such debates taking place in the courts of kings like Janak, when people from various shades of thoughts, because Hinduism was never following one particular pattern of thinking. There was Bhakti Marg, there was non-dualism, there was Advait Marg, there was Charvaks who did not believe in any god. So all of them, Janak king, King Janak, used to assemble them, provoking them to debate, not trying to influence anybody, but inviting the thoughts and then leaving the debate to the people at large to make up their own mind. So that was the tradition of our Hindu religion in this land of India. That was also the tradition of Islam. In the immediately succeeding years after the demise of Prophet Muhammad, Islam was a religion, Arabia was the place which was the place of learning. Logics, mathematics, astronomy, all this was being discussed, and the great scholars of Arabia imbibed the thought, made inquiries, and transformed that knowledge thereafter to the Western world. According to me, the Renaissance movement in Europe owes its origin to the thinking of these Arab thinkers who were great stalwarts in their own time. We very often associate Arabia with thinking about Arabian Nights. But let me tell you that apart from the strides which they made in the field of fiction and some of the most imaginative fictions, at the same time in the field of science, technology, thinking, logics, mathematics, they made great strides. That is why today also, in spite of all the achievements, the West is still talking about the numerals as the Arabic numerals. And this is how Islam also in those days used to think openly. That tradition has been continued, because I believe in the realm of King Akbar. He also used to call people from all religions, even the Christians who came at that time. They landed on the shore of India. They were also called and they were asked to explain what are the tenets of the religion. So this sort of healthy debate is something which is an absolute necessity for the development of any cultured, civilized, and tolerant society. Dr. Vora said that he is neutral. Let me tell him and all of you, I am also neutral. If I would not have been neutral, I would not have been made the chief guest. And I do not wish to desire to make any final comment on the subject. But one school of thought I would like to narrate here, which I read at some place, that all those animals in nature who are grass eaters, the animals which are thriving on leaves, they have got bovine teeth. They do not have canine teeth. All those animals which are eating flesh, meat eaters, they have got canine teeth, what we call rakshi. Human being is the one species which has got both bovine teeth as well as canine teeth. So it is very likely that nature wanted this species to survive. Nature considered that this species, human beings, are the most important species which should be there in this world. They should try to contribute. They should try to carry my message and take it further. So they wanted, the nature probably wanted, this species to survive under all circumstances. Nobody can deny. Then the early Homo sapiens or Homo erectus, they are all flesh eaters. At that time there was no agriculture. If you look at the evolution as we now learn from science, it is only the advance of civilization that people started taking to agriculture. When they started taking to agriculture and started growing corns, some of them became vegetarian, some of them remained non-vegetarian, some of them became the mixture of both. They also took vegetarian as well as non-vegetarian. And most of the non-vegetarian people today also eat vegetarian food as a part of their diet. I believe that in this aspect, when you are talking whether it is permitted or prohibited, we are talking about permission or prohibition by the religion. In this one aspect, Dr. Naik, I would probably like to differ from you. I believe that it is not the function of religion to tell us what we should eat and what we should not eat. Religion should try to purify our soul, purify our conscience, talk about good behavior, lead us to the path of God. What we should eat, what we should not eat is something which the doctors should tell us. The nutrition experts should tell us. It is not the function of the religion to say you shall not eat garlic, you shall not eat onions, you shall not eat ginger. Because this is something, if subsequently the nutritional experts tell us that this is something which is very good for your health, which is very good for your survival, which is very good for you to fight your diseases, then certainly it has to be taken. Because these are the subjects in modern day science. We have to grow up. We have to think in terms of what is lying ahead of us. We are entering now the next millennium, 21st century. So much is expected from us. Today only I was reading in one of the magazines about the forecast of Nostradamus. And Nostradamus thinks that this particular country, which is surrounded on three sides by sea, that one country will come on the top of the world. And are we going to go into the top of the world, become a superpower, by just clinging ourselves to some of the outdated notions? For example, yesterday, so many people migrated from this country. I was wondering in the heart of my heart, what is it? There is no scientific explanation all throughout. All people with any basis of logic, all people who knew something about science, they were saying nothing will happen whether eight planets come in one line or they go zigzag. Nothing is going to happen. But then all types of talks were there. Alang, which was our largest shipyard, that was completely forsaken and completely deserted. I was told that for rushing to Rajasthan, I don't understand why people from Rajasthan are so panicky. The Marwaris left everything, came here and made an empire. And the same Marwaris, thinking the eight planets are there, they ran away. I was told 2,500 rupees were paid for a bus ticket for going back to Rajasthan, and nothing happened. So what is very important for all of us, if this country has to go further, if we as a nation has to make our mark, and probably the destiny is before us, we can reach great strides. 21st century, as I've always been saying, belongs to India and Pakistan. Both of them, when they will come nearer and nearer, they will be able to become the leaders of the 21st century. And if that is going to happen, then let me tell you, we will have to get out of these old dogmas. What we should eat, we should not eat, the doctor should tell us. If a new scientific discovery is made, and I've been asked that I should eat tomatoes because it fights the cancerous growth, then I must eat tomatoes, irrespective of what my religion tell me. So I think let us go to the scientists. Let us develop for ourselves a modern mind, a scientific approach. Then I think today or tomorrow, the whole world is before us. I don't want to comment on the or trespass on the domain of the speakers. With this introductory remarks, I am once again trying to point out I am absolutely neutral. And I would like to hear the views of the learned people who have made research on the subject. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Trivedi. Now we have brief introductions of each of the speakers before we get into the mode of formal dialogue program. We have Mr. Chamanbhai Vora, Senior Vice President of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, to introduce Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri.
Well, today I feel very happy to introduce our President, Sri Rashmibhai Zaveri, President of the Indian Vegetarian Congress. I think this public dialogue will become very, very interesting looking to the introductory speech given by our chief learned guest, V.S. Trivedi. So let us hope for the very good dialogue. Now, Rashmibhai Zaveri is a chartered accountant by profession. He is having his own firm, Rashmi Zaveri and Company. They are very well reputed in the field of, as far as the corporate sector is concerned. And he is a very good speaker as far as the religious speeches are concerned. He is a master of many of the religious philosophies. He is a very active member of the Chartered Accountant Society. Himself is the member of the Bharat Jain Mahamandal. He is the founder president of the Forum of Jain Intellectuals, one of the very prominent institutions as far as the Jain people are concerned. And he is very well connected with the Kala Gurjari also. Though he is very young, at the age of 63, he is very energetic. And he looks forward always to this type of dialogues, and today's dialogue is really a very good one. And I, especially before, by giving the introduction of Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, I would like to thank our chief guest as well as our Dhanraj ji and our Zakir Naik sahab for having a very good dialogue, whether by principle a human being can take or should not take the vegetarian and non-vegetarian foods. Thank you very much.
Mr. Ashraf Mohammadi to introduce Dr. Zakir Naik.
Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik, 33 years, is the president of the Islamic Research Foundation, Mumbai. Though a medical doctor by professional training, he is renowned as a dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir removes misconceptions about Islam on the basis of Qur'an, Hadith, and religious scriptures of various other religions. He also uses reason, logic, and modern scientific facts to remove the misconceptions about Islam. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 3 years itself, he has delivered more than 300 public talks worldwide. Dr. Zakir also appears on various international TV and satellite TV channels throughout the world. He has also participated in various symposias and such dialogues with prominent personalities of various faiths.
I have been asked by many persons, why are we having this dialogue, this topic, these speakers only? I hereby clarify. Mr. Dhanraj Salecha, president of Rushabh Foundation, once visited the Islamic Research Foundation office about 1.5 months ago. He presented the Islamic Research Foundation kindly with a set of literature favoring vegetarianism. These included quotations from major world religions, which included quotations also from the Quran and sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which according to him indicate that non-vegetarian food is prohibited for human beings. After some discussions, Mr. Salecha proposed that a public dialogue be held at Patkar Hall between Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, president of the Indian Vegetarian Congress, and Dr. Zakir Naik, president of Islamic Research Foundation, on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? This would, in turn, enable the audience at large to know the different viewpoints of both the speakers and form their own judgment. Both the speakers agreed to the same. Just about 5 days back, that is this Tuesday, I met Mr. Zaveri, and he requested that both the speakers in their talk refrain from speaking on other religions except their own. Dr. Zakir, though being very ardently in the field of comparative religion, reluctantly agreed. Therefore, as far as the religious points are concerned in the talk and response of our speakers, Mr. Zaveri will speak only from the Jain viewpoint unless compelled otherwise. Similarly, Dr. Zakir will speak only from the Islamic viewpoint unless compelled otherwise. This, in brief, is the clarifying background to the dialogue. The format for the dialogue will be as agreed to and decided fair by the speakers. Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri will first address us for 50 minutes on the topic, is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Then Dr. Zakir Naik will make his presentation for 50 minutes on the same topic. This would be followed by a response session in which Mr. Zaveri will respond for 15 minutes to the matter presented by Dr. Zakir. Similarly, Dr. Zakir too would then respond for 15 minutes to the matter presented by Mr. Zaveri. When 5 minutes are left for the conclusion of the talk or the response time, I would put before each speaker a plate saying 5 minutes left, in which time they are expected to conclude. Lastly, we would have the question and answer session in which the audience may pose questions to each of the speakers alternately on the question mics provided in the auditorium. Written questions on slips of paper would be given secondary preference if time allows us. Now, I would request our first speaker, Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, to present his address. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri.
Before I start my talk, I am really very happy that this atmosphere of brotherhood, it has really moved me And I will request Dr. Zakir Naik to come forward and let's have a gale lagja scene. The chief guest of this morning, Mr. Y.P. Trivedi, President of Rushabh Corporation, Sri Dhanraj Salecha, the learned speaker, Dr. Zakir Naik, the expert commentator and the coordinator, Dr. Mohammed Naik, Vice President of IBC, Sri Chamanbhai Vora, other dignitaries on and off the dais, my friends, brothers and sisters. First of all, I must acknowledge the dedication, the sincerity with which all the three organizations, particularly Islam Research Foundation, has taken pains in arranging this lecture. I don't mind and I don't hesitate in saying the entire credit goes to IRF. Friends, the topic today is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Any argument or any statement for that matter is always to be considered from a relative point of view. There cannot be any absolute truth, there cannot be any absolute statement that it is 100% prohibited or 100% permitted. So friends, let's see, as very rightly put in by Mr. Trivedi, who started the ball rolling, that we will not speak only from religious point of view. Religious has to enter. You can't divorce it from today's subject. But I would like to speak on this topic, that non-veg food is prohibited for human being from various angles. For example, geographical reason, historical reason, moral, ethical, and religious reason, economical, environmental, and ecological reasons, natural reasons and psychological reasons, and above all, medical reasons. It's a fact now well established that our actions are controlled by our thoughts. What we think, we act. And our thoughts are controlled by our diet. As we eat, so we behave. And that's why the topic is very important, that we should choose our diet in such a way that our thinking is positive. The word positive will include everything. And believe me, friends, not only all the religions, but the medical science has now proved that the food that we take, it definitely influences our thinking and so our behavior. Friends, there was a time when there was no alternative available, as Mr. Trivedi rightly put. There were places on this world, and there are even now places where there is no availability of vegetation. It is simply not possible because of the extreme circumstances. But now the world has progressed so much that there is a very advanced
system of transportation which is available to us. And any type of commodity, including food, can be transported from one part of the globe to another without any problem. Now that when we have got alternatives, we have to think about this, which alternative is better from all the angles that which I have described earlier. And that's why, friends, I am now coming to my topic proper, that non-veg food is not permitted now at this point of time, not only for India, but for other countries of the world also. First of all, I will say that all Indian philosophies have stated that we should not harm any living being, not only the living beings that we can see, but also those living beings which we cannot see, which are in air, fire, water, etc. But always there is a limit. It's very difficult for a human being to refrain from total ahimsa, total hinsa or violence because of his needs. So that is why Lord Mahavir stated that at least you limit the essential killings, but absolutely no killing for your own selfish motive or for your own needs of hunger, etc. And that is why under Jainism and most of the Indian philosophies, non-veg food is totally prohibited. Now this is a religious aspect. I will not go very deep into it. But the psychological aspect, the effect that non-veg food has on our thoughts and deeds, that is the most important part. The learned authors, I will not now quote the names of the books and authors because that will take time. But I have got all the authorities with me. It is said that veg diet reduces needless suffering in the world and also preserves our ecosystem. See, when I talk about alternative, you look here, you look at the wild animals who stay in jungle. Those who are carnivorous, they will restrict themselves to meat eating only. But those animals which are herbivorous, they will never go for meat eating. Only human being is such because of some false notions, I will say. It is the human being has been both a carnivorous and herbivorous. As I said, if alternative is available, why should we go for unnecessary killing? The basic principle underlying this theory is non-violence, love, and compassion for animals, birds, fish, etc. Because flesh food falls in not essential category, while vegetarian food comes under essential category. Psychologically also, cruelty, instant impulses, urges, basic animal instincts, impatience are all the necessary consequences of flesh food. By eating animal flesh, man will ingest all the animal instincts, the four basic animal instincts of food, fear, possessiveness, and reproduction. These are there in man, I don't say no, but they are the basic instincts. We have got a reasoning mind. We can rise above these basic instincts. We can control our impulses and urges and become, then only we can become super animals or super beings. Otherwise, human being and animals, there is no difference at all. But man has additional quality called reasoning mind, which is blunted by the influence of flesh food, and man becomes more like animal. The scientific reason for this is that flesh is an integral part of animal body. It is full of tamasic value. There are three types of values: tamasic, rajasic, and sattvic. Tamasic, in short, is the brutal sense or brutal instincts of animal. a man becomes more like an animal. He is callous, he is cruel, he is ignorant. If he is eating the food, that is the part of the bodies of the dead animals. The crime rate is higher. Aggression in the natural is the natural consequences of flesh food. It distorts the thinking and reasoning. It is not only a problem by itself, but it creates many other problems like increase in crimes, cruelty, etc. The virtues like compassion, sharing, self-control are obliterated by the impact of flesh food. If we insist on treating animals more brutally, then our behavior will also become less human and more brutal. I will quote one shayari that what will happen if this animal instincts is so embedded in our heart, what will become of man? Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ki shakl se ab dar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi ko loot kar ghar bhar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Aadmi hi marta hai mar raha hai aadmi. Samajh kuch aata nahi kya kar raha hai aadmi. Friends, this is because the man has become an animal. He does not then distinguish between whether he is an animal or a human being, because this is the influence of the food, the flesh food that he eats. Flesh food is the cause of PMS syndrome, that is preposterous mood swing and psychological distortions. Thus, it is now established that if flesh food is the root cause of moral and spiritual degeneration. We at Indian Vegetarian Congress, we are working for an important task, since it will lead to a more humane world at peace with animal kingdom and with each other. We at IVC define a vegetarian as one who does not at any time or under any circumstances eat meat, fish, fowl, eggs, or any other type of flesh food. Vegetarian does not come from vegetable. Now, this is very important, friends, understand. The word vegetarian does not come from vegetable. The root is derived from the word vegetus, V-E-G-E-T-U-S, meaning whole, sound, fresh, lively. Nothing is more powerful than an individual acting out of his conscience, thus helping to bring the collective conscience to life. That is what Norman Cousin said. And what does Albert Schweitzer has to say? Until man extends his circle of compassion to all living things, man will not find peace for himself. It is a man's sympathy with all creatures that first makes him truly a human being. Now, friends, I will go next to the most important topic, and that is the medical viewpoint. It's a fallacy, friend. It's a myth to say that we don't get enough protein from veg food. And that is why a man must have flesh food that is rich in protein. I'll come one by one to these myths. First of all, I will first give you examples of those strong animals, say elephant, say rhino. These are the strongest animals on this earth. Are they meat eaters? No. They are pure veg. Even if they die, they will not eat meat. Even then, they are the strongest. Take example of horse. We talk about horse power. It's the most powerful creature useful for our purpose, and that is also a pure vegetarian. And take examples of cattle, cows, bullock, and other animals. They are not only useful to us, but they are pure vegetarian. My point here is that those vegetarian animals are strong enough and they don't need any flesh food. In fact, if stupidly flesh food is given to these veg animals, what will happen? You all know about the mad cow disease, the syndrome called BEC. Friends, this BSE, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, you know what happened a few years back in England. It was a result of feeding rendered sheep byproducts to cattle as protein supplement. These sheep were infected with scrapie, an AC disease known for over 200 years. Now, if sheep food can make a cow mad, what do you expect the result on human being? Millions of innocent cows were killed mercilessly just because they were suspected to be infected with BSE, and that too for no fault of theirs, but the stupid ways of feeding sheep protein on absolutely unnatural diet for a cow. So is the case with humans. Animal protein is not natural for us. Similarly, millions of chicks were destroyed in Eastern Asia countries because they were infected with certain disease. Now, coming back to healthy diet, I will quote from one Dr. Dean Ornish, who has written a very learned book on how to reverse heart disease without surgery or drugs. And this book, my friends, is the bestseller in America now. It has really created interest in the people of America and all over the world for that matter, that veg food is definitely better from medical point of view. He has given two types of diet, one reversal and one prevention of heart disease. Both are strictly veg diets because he has proved scientifically that veg food is the best food for a human being. It not only helps heart patients, but also reduces risk of other degenerating and fatal diseases caused by flesh food. Diseases like cancers of colon, cancers of breast, cancers of prostate, obesity, high blood pressure, stroke, diabetes, gallstones. The Surgeon General of America has confirmed this in the report on nutrition and health. He has given certain facts for protein. Friends, we'll have to be a little technical about it. The protein is formed from building blocks called amino acids. These are of million varieties, of which only three are critical for us: lysine, tryptophan, and methionine. All these are available in animals as well as veg, plant food. But when one consumes animal food for getting these three critical amino acids, one also consumes unnecessary elements like cholesterol, saturated fat. Friends, these are the two things that are the prime reason, the killers for human being: cholesterol and saturated fat. Now let us address the issue that is universally put forward, that we do not get sufficient protein from vegetarian food. And so we have to turn to flesh food for adequate supply of amino acids. Now this is a fallacy. A combined meal of legumes and cereals. Legumes means dal, pulses, and cereals mean wheat, rice, etc. You have to combine these two and you get a complete balanced diet which provides complete protein, which is not different from protein found in eggs or meat, but without cholesterol and animal instincts. One dietic association has stated positive relationship between vegetable lifestyles and risk reduction for several chronic degenerative diseases, as mentioned earlier. It has confirmed that veg diet is healthier and more nutritious. Plant food is totally free from cholesterol, which is only found, which is found in both. But cholesterol is only found in animal products such as meat, poultry, fish, and dairy. Flesh food is also high in saturated fats, which our liver converts into cholesterol. Our body makes all the cholesterol we need. Now, this is very important, friends. You must understand. We need cholesterol, but we don't have to take cholesterol from animal food. Our body, it's a wonderful mechanism. The biochemistry, the chemical factory of our body can manufacture all proteins, all cholesterol from our own system. 3/4 of the cholesterol in our blood is made by our body. It is the excessive amounts of cholesterol and saturated fat in the diet that lead to coronary heart disease. The other diseases, friends, which I have summarized from various journals, medical journals, epilepsy, infected flesh, kidney diseases, excessive protein, excessive uric acid. These are all the diseases because of the flesh food. Rheumatoid, arthritis, gout. This is the direct consequence of uric acid found in flesh food. Degeneration of intestines, decay in immunity system. Dr. Deepak Chopra of America has stated that our body is capable of living for more than 100 years if we take proper care of it. Now look at the population in north, extreme north region, Eskimos. Now perforce, because no vegetation is available, they have to take flesh food. And the average life of an Eskimo is only 30 years. All non-veg food is devoid of vitamin C and vitamin A, which is naturally available in vegetables. Avidin in eggs and other dangerous bacteria are responsible for many skin diseases such as eczema, scabies, leprosy, etc. Now I'll give you a certain scientific facts. One medical study has proved that there are less heart diseases in veg people than flesh eaters. Second, it's a well-known fact that not only in India, but even in advanced countries, there is no foolproof system of medical exam of animals before slaughtering. Thus, diseases carried by them are passed on to the humans who eat flesh food. Friends, we all know that like human beings, the animals are also infected by diseases. And they are the carriers of the deadliest germs. And when these animals, they die and one eats that flesh, that diseases which were infected and which were the part of the dead body of that animal is again inherited by us. 9% of food poisoning cases, 90% of food poisoning cases are in flesh food eaters. When an animal or bird is brought to a slaughterhouse, now this is a friend which is again, it needs some explanation. If you have visited a slaughterhouse or a poultry, you will know this. When the animals are brought to the slaughterhouse, and when they know that they are going to be slaughtered, the pain, the agony, the anguish that runs in the system, it gives rise to adrenaline, the hormones, which mixes with the blood and into the flesh. Now these instincts of fear, anguish, anger, despair, all negative points are then becoming part of the flesh food and it passes on to the person who eats. And that is why, friends, I say that when one eats flesh food, he becomes more like animal and less like a human being. I will now turn to the fallacy that eggs are necessary for growing children because they contain protein. As I said, excessive protein is more harmful than useful. And the protein that we find in pulses, in cereals, is much more richer and natural than the protein, the excessive protein we find in animal food. Now I'll give you the example of egg. Each egg weighs about 100 grams and has 170 calories. It contains 13.6% of protein, as against that any dal or pulse will contain 24% of protein, much more than the egg of same weight, 100 grams. Egg will contain 13.3% saturated fat, while there is no saturated fat or very little of 1% in cereals and pulses. 450 to 500 milligram of cholesterol is contained in egg, one egg. Amino acid called methionine, which destroys vitamin B. Large quantity of sodium salt. All these are part of the egg. And when one eats egg, he is then infected. His body is infected because of this excess protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. It does not contain any carbohydrate. It does not contain any fiber. Friends, the medical science has now come forward and stated that for our digestion, we must have fiber. and fiber is found only in vegetable food and not in the flesh food at all. Now, cost-wise, I'm only comparing the egg now, cost-wise. For 1 gram of protein, the cost of egg is 4 to 5 times more than the pulses, wheat or soybean. Cost of 100 calories, it is almost 10 times the costlier than the pulses. Thus, pulses, wheat, etc. are not only cheaper, but they provide other important nutritions like vitamins, minerals, fiber, etc. Now, let's take a look at the poultry farming. Now, they call it poultry farming. It's a totally misnomer. I tell you, sir, it is a poultry factory. The way in which the birds are stored there, they have to climb upon one another to eat or drink because there is not sufficient space. Even the poultry people, they say that this is our factory and these are our merchandise. They are goods, nothing but our products. We are not concerned whether they are living beings or not. They are totally devoid of any compassion, any karuna, and that is why these things are also reflected in the birds. The birds are stored like commodities. They are fed unnatural food and administered drugs which are harmful for humans only to speed up their metabolism so that they can produce more eggs. The poultry people are only interested in making profit. And the result of this, they die premature death. It affects physical as well as mental health, intellectual and emotional growth. Egg is poison for children. Egg begin to rot immediately unless they are put in deep fridge. But when they are marketed, they are prone to decay and disease faster. Vegetable egg is again a myth. It's a fallacy. No egg can be a vegetable egg. It's an animal product, an animal product only. It is definitely it's definitely an animal product. It can never be called vegetable item. It's a misnomer. It's a deception. Friends, I will now turn to the economical aspect. Now, these also I have studied from various journals, medical science, and more important, from the statistics department of the government of India and government of America, the UK government, etc. But I will note, that's why give you the citations during my talk, but I will give you the summary. UK. The survey has stated the land required to produce the fodders to feed the animals to obtain flesh food is 14 times more than that required for vegetable diet to feed men directly. Because what happens? First you grow fodder, you feed it to the animals, and then you kill the animals for flesh food, and that is how you get your flesh food. But if the same land is used for agriculture, for pulses and cereals, that same piece of land can support many more families, and here only few families can be supported by using this land for pasture. I have been given one statistics. 10 square acres of land can support 10 heads of human beings or 10 heads of cattle for the whole year. But 10 heads of cattle for meat cannot support even one single person throughout the year. Natural grass or pasture can, and grain crop both genetically belong to grass family. You see, once the crop is harvested, what we have is sashish or stalks. These are again the source of, excellent source of biochemical fertilizer or manure. Look how many crores of rupees of our foreign exchange we are wasting on artificial fertilizer and chemical fertilizer, which we all know is extremely harmful to us. But because we are not able to get the natural manure, which we can get from cattle and animals, we are destroying them, foolishly destroying them for our own food. But we are not considering the fact that the manure that these animals produce are much more economical, much more healthier, and much more useful to our country. It's now well-known fact that 16 kilograms of food grain are required to be fed to one animal for forming 1 kilogram of meat. Thus, by feeding animals reared for slaughter, the country is deprived of vital food grains which can feed many, many more people. So, not only for growing food, but also for pasture and for manure, we require land. The human oncogene work done by Professor Wilbing from Massachusetts, it has stated that to obtain 1 calorie of animal flesh, 7 vegetable calories have to be spent. And the study further shows that the land needed to graze 1 average animal can sustain 5 average families. I will not burden you with facts and figures, but the summary of all this is that it is very economical to feed people on veg diet rather than on flesh food. Now let's take the other point of view of economy, ecology, environment, slaughterhouses, etc. Production of animal flesh food require more land, more water, more food grains for feeding animals meant for slaughtering. Now this will again destroy or rather disturb the balance of our ecology and environment. Because the resources are always limited, we have to make best use of that. Either we grow crops or we rear animals for slaughtering. And look at the way the slaughterhouses work, how they are maintained. It's simply a hygienic horror. The conditions are appalling and totally unsanitary all over the world. Yesterday only on internet I got a report from foreign countries, advanced countries of America and France, that the conditions of slaughterhouses there also, it is reported, are totally unsanitary. I got a copy of white papers from a government accountability project of America, fighting filth on the kill floor, a matter of life and death for America's families. Slaughtering of animals, meat processing plants, and finally most unhygienic ways of transport and sale of flesh food has made flesh food totally unfit for human consumption. And do not think for a moment that imported, packaged, nicely packaged meat or canned meat is totally hygienic. No, my dear friends, that is also coming from those slaughterhouses where all these things which I have stated of medical science will apply. Not only that, they add certain preservatives, certain chemicals, certain additives which will keep the meat fresh. Environmental consciousness in India and abroad has now driven many people to vegetarianism. Environment-friendly veg foods are now available. The craze now in all over the world is to go for environmental-friendly veg food because it is considered friendly and healthy. The green factories or glass houses are now exporting plant food, including fruits, to those countries which cannot grow them because of climate. The modern transportation system has given a much better alternative for food choice. In fact, for developing nations like India, government and NGOs should give more emphasis on larger production of more exports of plant food, which will serve the economic development of our country. Now look at the pollution. The pollution caused by legal and illegal slaughterhouses is terrific. The discharge of effluents from even so-called modern abattoirs is in the open and exposed to elements and public gaze. The carcasses of animals, the flow of blood, the horrible stench, etc., will add to the pollution. Ecological balance. Utility of animal world for human welfare cannot be overemphasized. Both are interdependent. Cows, sheep, fish, frogs, etc. are much more useful to us alive than dead. Then why should we kill our friends and our helpers to satisfy our taste buds? We should not be so much ungrateful, my friends, to our lesser beings, we call them animals or birds. Look at it from another point of view of natural manure. I've already stated that the animals produce much more natural and healthy manure than the artificial manure. Artificial chemicals, manures cost us dearly. Now again, I'm coming back to our economic term. We are importing artificial chemicals for manure purposes. That is again a drain on our exchequer. Friends, I will now briefly give you historical and geographical views. I have already touched upon it. Historically, in certain dry areas of miles and miles of desert where no vegetable can ever grow, maybe only food was survival was the animal food. Geographically, I stated as like Eskimos, there was no alternative. But once we have got this better alternative, which is healthier, which is more economical, which is more eco-friendly, why not go for such food? And friends, I will now go to the most important point, which will prove my point beyond any doubt that why man is vegetarian by nature. I've got some 16 points here to compare how our body is built up. As Mr. Trivedi has started the ball rolling in this fashion of bovine teeth and non-bovine teeth embed. Now I will first say about herbivorous. Teeth of herbivorous animals are embedded in the jaws, short, blunt, close to one another. While in carnivorous, they are sharp, pointed, long, and conical. The two or four teeth that we have got, like some people say they are like dog animals, they are not for meat eating, but they are found also in apes and chimpanzees, and which are fit for plucking the fruits and eating the fruits. The claws, no sharp nails for herbivorous, they are fit to pluck fruits only, while in carnivorous, the sharp nails helps in tearing apart the prey easily. Jaws and chewing habits. Jaws of herbivorous will move up and down, left and right, that is in all directions. They swallow their food after chewing. While the carnivorous, the lower jaw moves upwards and downwards only. They swallow their food without mastication. Now friends, you go on comparing this. I will only say herbivorous and carnivorous. It is for you enlightened friends to see how our human body and parts of our human body will fit, whether it will fit with herbivorous animals or with carnivorous animals. Tongue. The tongue of herbivorous is quite smooth, while that of carnivorous is very rough. Water drinking habit. That's a very important thing. My friend Dr. Paresh Dalal told me. He said that these herbivorous animals, they drink water with lips by suction, while all the carnivorous, they drink the water with tongue, they lap up. We don't do it. We always use our lips. Now come to the length of intestine. Longer intestines are found in herbivorous, about four times the body length. This cannot quickly expel the flesh food. While in carnivorous, smaller size of intestine, almost equal to the body length, and helps to expel flesh food before it gets contaminated. Liver and kidney. Smaller in proportion in herbivorous, so they are unable to throw out waste material easily. While in carnivorous, liver and kidney are longer in proportion, so they can throw out waste material easily. Digestive system. There is a less hydrochloric acid in digestive system of herbivorous, thus flesh cannot be digested easily. While obviously in carnivorous, the quantum of hydrochloric acid is much more, and that is why they can digest the flesh food. But human being cannot. Salvia. In herbivorous, like human being, the salvia is alkaline and contains vitalin, which helps in digesting carbohydrates found in the grains. While in carnivorous, the salvia is always acidic. The blood pH is alkaline, like human being in herbivorous, and acidic in carnivorous. The blood lipoproteins. Human blood lipoproteins is similar to all herbivorous, while it is not similar to that of carnivorous. Sense is weak. All the senses, particularly the eyesight, is weak in herbivorous and very powerful in carnivorous. Sound, the voice is not the herbivorous sound, or even the human sound is not frightening, unless of course we can make it now frightening. But by nature, the sound of all herbivorous is mild, while that of carnivorous, like lions and tigers, is very coarse and frightening. and lastly infants. Normal sight power of right from now, see the young ones of herbivorous, right from the moment of birth, they can see very clearly. While all the infants of carnivorous wild animals are blind at least for a week. Now friends, it is for you to justify whether man fits by nature in this category of herbivorous grain eaters or in the category of carnivorous the flesh eaters. Now friends, I will now tell you about certain great persons who condemned flesh food. Looking at the world's history, we find that all great scholars, philosophers, scientists like Einstein, artists like Leonardo da Vinci, poets like Milton, Pope, Shelley, and writers like George Bernard Shaw, and religious leaders, of course, of the world. Now, who are those people? The mathematician, the Pythagoras, the Plutarch, Newton and Einstein, the scientist, Dr. Annie Besant, Reverend Dr. Walter Walsh, George Bernard Shaw, Tolstoy, the Greek philosopher Socrates and Aristotle. They are all enlightened people, and they say,
yes, sir.
They say that blessed are those with noble qualities of tolerance and compassion, love and non-violence, who are not flesh eaters. Now, friends, I will quote from George Bernard Shaw, which is very famous and widely published. We are living graves of murdered beasts. Listen what he says. We are living graves, moving graves of murdered beasts, slaughtered to satisfy our appetites. Like carrion crows, we live and feed on meat, regardless of the sufferings and the pain. Doctors once advised Bernard Shaw. He was very ill. He said that you must take some meat soup. Bernard Shaw said, I'll prefer death than to have anything with flesh food. And believe me, friends, he survived, and the doctor turned vegetarian. In the similar way, Mahatma Gandhi, his son was very sick. He was advised meat soup, and he refused, and the son survived. Why I'm telling you, friends, all these things? That Mr. Trivedi said, yes, medically, whatever the doctor says, we have to accept, no doubt. But as I said in the very first thing, in the beginning I said, everything is relative. When doctor says something, he will say only from medical point of view. And friends, we are not living here. We are here on this earth, not only to survive. Survival is important, but not at the cost of others and inflict pain on others. Thank you very much, friends. 21st century will belong to vegetarians. I think I have made my points on very general terms, friends. I will tell you that I know those who are regularly flesh eaters are coming from some culture, some family, some faith, and that is why they have never applied their mind. And that is what Mr. Trivedi stated, that we are here today. We have gathered here. Let us apply our mind, that not only from religious angle or from our social angle. Because I have seen, I'm not afraid to say, that many of our Jain friends, when they go to certain gatherings, because they are afraid of the social status, they start eating meat. I don't like that. But then it is for everybody, whether he is a vegetarian or a non-vegetarian. Apply your mind. Try to see from all these angles whether it is permitted or prohibited from our own health point of view, from the national point of view, from the social point of view, from ecological, from environmental, and above all, from compassion point of view. Friends, when nature has created all animals, all humans, all creatures equal, nobody has got right to kill anybody just to satisfy his own palates. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Zakir Naik to present his talk.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Ala Rasulillah. Wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Awfu bil uqud. أهلت لكم بهيمة الأنام إلا ma yutla alaykum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbi shrahli sadri. Waysir li amri. Wahlul uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Respected Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri, Mr. Trivedi, Dr. Muhammad Naik, the respected people on the dais, my respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this morning's debate is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? It is not whether vegetarian food or non-vegetarian food which is healthy or which is better. If I prove that an apple is better than a mango, that doesn't mean mango is prohibited. This statement is sufficient to end the dialogue for me, but I have to reply. Non-vegetarian, by definition, means a person who has food of animal origin. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetarian food. It does not mean a person who does not have vegetables and fruits. Let it be very clear to all of you. A more technical and a scientific word is an omnivorous diet. A person who has many types of food, especially foods of plant and animal origin. Vegetarian, as Mr. Rashmibhai has very rightly said, it doesn't come from the word vegetables. It comes from vegetas, which means full of breath, full of life. He didn't give a better explanation. You can talk about it. And he didn't speak. There are various types of vegetarian. We have fructarian, who only eat fruits and nuts. Then we have the vegans, who don't have any animal products. We have lacto-vegetarian, what I believe Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri is. They have milk. We have the ovo-vegetarians, who have eggs. We have the lacto-ovo-vegetarian, who have egg and milk also. We have the pesco-vegetarian, who eat fish. We have semi-vegetarian, who also have chicken. This classification is done by the vegetarian society, not by me. And you can name another 20. Time doesn't permit me. I would like to state a quotation by Dr. William T. Jarvis. Dr. William T. Jarvis, he is the advisor to the American Council of Science and Health, ACSH. And he's also the professor of public health and preventive medicine in the Loma Linda University. And he's also the founder and the president of the National Council Against Health Frauds. And he's the co-editor of the book, The Health Robbers, A Closer Look at Quackery in America. Most of the quotations are from America. And according to him, he classifies vegetarian based on the behavior standpoint into two categories: pragmatic vegetarian and ideological vegetarian. A pragmatic vegetarian chooses his diets on objective health reasons. He is more reasonable in his approach rather than emotional. The ideological vegetarian, on the other hand, he chooses his diet based on a principle, which is based on an ideology. He is more emotional rather than reasonable. And Dr. William B. Jarvis says, one can spot an ideological vegetarian by his exaggerations of the benefits of vegetarianism. And you could see that in the talk which preceded my talk. Exaggeration of benefits of vegetarianism and the lack of skepticism and the overlooking of the fact that extreme vegetarianism can lead to potential health risks. He says that the ideological vegetarian, he pretends to be like a scientist, but he's more like a lawyer than like a scientist. And you could see that in the talk by the learned speaker. More like a lawyer than like a scientist. They gather data and information selectively against the information which is against the ideology. This may be good for a debate like the one we're having, but not for engendering scientific understanding. Dr. William D. Jarvis says that ideological vegetarianism is filled with hypotheses. It is filled with extremism from which even scientists and doctors are not immune. And there you can see the quotation. Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri has said several diseases. And it's possible for me to refute each and every, but if time permits. He's talking about science, but the approach was not scientific. All can be prevented very well. Prevention is better than cure, is the base of the medicine, which time will not permit me to go into health issues, etc. In the rebuttal, if time permits, I'll try and cover most of the other aspects. And health, I will try and cover in the rebuttal. Let's analyze the various reasons why a person chooses a food habit. It can be religious, it can be geographical location, it can be personal choice, smell, taste, color, due to humane or ethical consideration, due to anatomical and physiological consideration, due to behavioral consideration. It can be due to ecological and economical consideration. It can be due to nutritional value or due to health and scientific reasons. Health and medical reasons. Let's first analyze the religious reasons. Mr. Trivedi said that religion should not interfere with the human being where it's concerned what we should eat and what we should not eat. That you should leave it up to the doctors. I agree with him that most of the religions, that is the case. The religious authorities, the main foundation that's Almighty God, if he's not a doctor, the God that you worship is not a doctor, then you should not follow him. He says, leave it to the doctors. But in Islam, we believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, is our creator. And the creator of the human beings has far superior knowledge than all the doctors put together in all the years. And you can find the statements, as Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri said, all from doctors. He's quoting from these books, which I think is available for sale outside, all these books. I will touch on some of these points, all out of which many are fictitious. Fictitious don't exist at all. Some are irrelevant. Some are untested, and some are truths, which are half-baked truths. I would like to make one point crystal clear. That while I prove undoubtedly that non-veg food should be permitted for the human beings, I do not have the slightest intention to hurt the feelings of any vegetarians. And while I prove logically and scientifically that non-veg food is permitted, and if someone feels hurt, his sentiments are hurt, I apologize in advance. I sincerely apologize. My intention is not to hurt anybody's feeling, but I have to reply to the presentation of the earlier speaker. As far as Islam is concerned, it is not compulsory for a human being to have non-veg. A Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. But, when our Creator, Almighty God Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives us permission to have non-veg, why should we not have it? And I started my talk by giving a quotation from the glorious Quran, from Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 1, which says, Ya ayyuhal ladzina amanu, O you believe, awfu bil ukud, uhillat lakum bahimatul anam, illa ma yutla alaykum. Fulfill all your obligations. And lawful for you for food are all four-footed animals with the exceptions named. Quran further says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 5, that cattle has been created by God for you. In it are various benefits. You derive warmth, and of the meat you can eat. The same message is repeated in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse 21, that you can have the meat of the cattle. Let's analyze the geographical reasons and the surrounding environment. And as we know, it influences a person's food habit. Like people living in the coastal region, the Kokanis, they have more fish. People living in South India, they have more rice. People living in the deserts, where the scarcity of vegetation, people mainly survive on the flesh of animals. The Eskimo, the Arctic region, where there's scarcity of edible vegetation, they survive more on seafood. And Mr. Zaveri said that he knows that vegetable is not available in certain parts of the world, but today, due to advancement of transportation, we can supply them with vegetables. I would request the Indian Vegetarian Congress to supply, at least give the transportation cost, that's all, to supply to the Eskimos, to supply to Saudi Arabia. You get vegetables in Saudi Arabia, it is more expensive. Why? Because the cost of transportation. That makes it more expensive. It is illogical and unscientific to spend more money to buy a food which is less nutritious. Let's analyze the humane reasons, the ethical reasons, and the pure vegetarians, they say, that all life is sacred and no living creature should be killed. They fail to realize that today it's a universal fact that even plants have got life. So the main argument on killing living creature doesn't hold good today. Previously, maybe. A couple of centuries ago, it may have held some weight, but today it carries no weight. Then they further argue today and they say, yes, we know that plants have got life, but they can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser crime and lesser sin as compared to killing an animal. Today, science has further advanced and we have come to know that even the plants can feel pain. They can even cry. But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human ear because the audible frequency range of the human ear is from 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below and above this, the human ear can't hear. But the cry of the animal can be heard by the human beings, but the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human beings. Just because you cannot hear the cry of the plant, that doesn't justify you to inflict pain or kill the plant. There was an ideological vegetarian who had a discussion with me and told me that, Brother Zakir, I know that plants have life, they feel pain, but you know, plants, they have got about 2 senses less as compared to the animals. I said, for sake of argument, I agree with you. But then I asked him a simple question. Let's suppose your brother is born deaf and dumb, cannot hear, cannot speak, 2 senses less. And when he grows up, and when someone comes and murders him, will you go and tell the judge, oh me Lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had 2 senses less? In fact, you will say, usne to masoom ko mara hai. He has killed an innocent person. Give him a bigger punishment. And further, if you analyze that in Islam, as far as living creatures are concerned, there are two types, broadly classified two types. Human beings who are living creatures and non-human being living creatures. As far as killing the human beings are concerned, Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, that if any person, if anyone, kills any human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading mischief in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole nation. If any person kills any human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for creating mischief, Quran says he has killed the whole of humanity. If you save any human being, you have saved the whole of humanity. As far as non-human being living creatures are concerned, no human being should harm them unnecessarily, should not kill them unnecessarily for sports or for fun or for target practice. But if it is for your security and for your safety, you can stop them, you can even kill them. Or if you want for lawful food, but not just for fun and frolic or for hunting. Even if I agree that the plants are a lesser species as compared
to the human beings. If you take the life of one animal, an average animal, it can feed about 100 human beings. For the same 100 human beings, you may have to kill more than 100 plants. So is it preferable to take the life of one living animal or the life of 100 living plants? Which is a bigger sin? Is it a bigger sin to kill 100 human beings who are handicapped or kill one healthy human being? Which is a bigger sin? You decide for yourself. There is a vegetarian society by the name of World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. Most of the quotation which he gave is from here and from these three books, most of them, almost all. The name of the foundation is World Foundation on Reverence for All Life. They forgot to mention except plant life in bracket. And it says, all creation is one family. All life is sacred. What kind of an ideology is this that you permit the killing of one family member but do not permit the killing of the other family member? It's illogical and unscientific. You know, in America, there are vegetarian society who take students to slaughterhouses and they make them see the bloodshed and convert them to vegetarianism. It is like a doctor taking the young girls to observe and watch a difficult childbirth and then say, that is the reason you should not marry and should not have children. These are unethical forms of mind control. Unethical. Unethical. In fact, we should teach our children that when vegetables can be grown for food, why can't animals be raised for food? All life is sacred. I agree. Unnecessary killing them is wrong. But for a requirement, lawful food is permitted. Let's analyze the anatomical and the behavioral consideration. And there were a list of various things mentioned by Mr. Zaveri. You know, he was reading from paper at 100 miles per hour, asking to note down. How many diseases? I, being a medical doctor, can answer, but how much can answer? To name 10 diseases will take a few seconds. To reply all 10 will take more than an hour. And he has listed a lot. I'll just try and tell you that if you go to authentic books, not researches made by ideological vegetarians, most of the answers are given on the medical aspect. Considering the anatomical and the physiological aspect, and he rightly said that if you observe the teeth of the herbivorous animal, the cow, the goat, the sheep, they have a flat set of teeth. They only have vegetables. If you observe the teeth of the carnivorous animal, lion, tiger, leopard, they have pointed set of teeth. They only have animal flesh. Not non-veg, animal flesh. They are not called as non-veg animals. They are called as carnivorous animals. There's a difference between carnivorous and non-veg. Non-veg actually is omnivorous. But if you analyze the set of teeth of the human beings, we have got flat teeth as well as pointed teeth. If Almighty God, our Creator, wanted us to have only vegetables, why did He give us these pointed teeth for? And Mr. Zaveri said, these pointed teeth, they are not referring to the dog. They refer to the apes. He doesn't know the scientific meaning of the word canine. Comes from the root word caninus in Latin, which means of dog. And canine means pertaining to the family of Canida, like wolves, dogs, etc. Scientists have given this name. Canine, meaning pertinent to dog. And he said, it doesn't look like the teeth of dogs. It refers to teeth of apes and monkeys. I believe in agreeing with the argument and proving my point, then you disprove him. It's easy. Even if I agree, it is the teeth like the monkeys. Do you know monkeys also have non-veg? They have the lice. There are many species of ape who even have raw flesh of animals. Many species of apes who have raw flesh, they're omnivorous. Who says they're carnivorous? They're omnivorous. They aren't pure veg also. And many species are even called as cannibals. Some species of apes and monkeys. If you analyze the digestive system of the human being, it can digest both veg as well as non-veg. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us a digestive system which can digest both veg as well as non-veg? And Mr. Zaveri said that we cannot have raw flesh. I agree with him, most human beings cannot have raw flesh. In the same way, most of the human beings cannot have raw vegetables, raw vegetarian diet, like raw wheat, raw rice. Can you have it? Raw mung, raw drumstick. Can you have? You'll get indigestion. So what is the argument? No, no, you have to cook them. I know as a medical doctor that raw wheat, raw rice, raw drumstick, if you have, you'll have problems. You can't digest them. So you have to cook them. Similarly with the flesh, we non-vegetarians, we cook them for easy digestion. But yet, there are certain human beings who even have raw meat. He gave the name of Eskimos. He didn't tell the root word meaning. The root word meaning of Eskimo, it literally means eaters of raw flesh. So there are human beings who even have raw meat. They are conditioned. Tomorrow, if you are conditioned to eat raw wheat and raw rice, even you may be able to digest it. But most human beings cannot digest certain raw vegetables. That doesn't mean you should not have rice, you should not have wheat, that you should not have drumsticks. There are, in the herbivorous animals, an enzyme known as cellulase enzyme. And every vegetable has cellulase. And this cellulase enzyme helps in digesting the vegetables. We human beings, we don't have cellulase enzymes. Therefore, the vegetables we eat, the cellulose part remains undigested, and we call them as fibers. It's undigested. On the other hand, there are certain enzymes like lipase, trypsis, chemotrypsis, which are mainly meant for digesting non-vegetarian food. If Almighty God did not want us to have non-veg food, why did he give us these enzymes? And the primitive man, as said by the earlier speaker as well as the chief guest, archaeological evidence shows us clearly the Homo sapiens, the Eskimos, the Australian aborigines, they were non-veg. So why the change now? We have the same teeth, we have the same digestive system, and he has given a list of other comparison which prove we can have veg. And I agree with that. Where did I ever say that you cannot have veg? A non-veg is a person who has the food of the animal products as well as vegetarian food. It's an omnivorous diet. He said that the liver and the kidney in carnivorous animal is large. In the human beings, it is small like the herbivorous because the animals have raw meat. Therefore, they have to remove the toxin on a higher level. We do it by cooking the food. Therefore, God gave us a small kidney and a small liver, which is sufficient to digest both cooked non-veg and also vegetables. Similarly, with all the arguments, HCl, it's not very acidic. Why? Because we don't require it. If we don't require it, why should God unnecessarily give it to us? Same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. All the arguments are that because they have raw flesh, therefore they require it. We don't require it. So why should God give us? Yes, it's required for digesting veg food and cooked non-veg food. He said, carnivorous animals, they lick. And the herbivorous animals, they sip. We human beings, we do both. We do both. When we drink, while we drink, we sip. When we have ice cream, what do? We lick. We lick also, and we sip also, depending upon what is the food we are eating. Even the tea we can lick, not that we can't lick. But why do we waste time? It will take more time. Similar with all the arguments he's given about the teeth being closed. Because we also have vegetables. If God would have asked us not to have vegetables, then maybe the teeth were far apart. He asked us to have both non-veg as well as veg food. And there are various verses in the Quran talking about various foods, pomegranates, talking about vegetables, talking about dates, etc., which we should have. the plants, many vegetarians say, that they regrow. Therefore, we aren't killing the plant, and there are some plants which have that facility, not all plants. There are various, which we cut, it regrows. So if this is the only argument, that because it regrows, you can have veg food, you know, if you cut the tail of the lizard, it regrows. Will you have the tail of the lizard? It's a delicacy. There are human beings, the Austin Aborigines, they relish the lizard. Will you have the tail of the lizard? And the answer will be no. You know what I'm doing now? I'm behaving like a lawyer. I'm feeling ashamed to answer all these things, but I have to do, because it is also a debate. I had come here so that we understand better and have a friendly understanding of each other, but I have to behave like a lawyer also, besides being logical and scientific, because the argument put forth, anyone who has general knowledge can reply. But because people don't have general knowledge, many people aren't aware. That's why these arguments may satisfy many people. And all these arguments are given in the books, which are distributed, Meat Eating, 100 Facts by Nemi Chan, distributed by Jain Organization, also by the Indian Vegetarian Congress. This is a book given to me by Mr. Zaveri. 100 Facts About Egg, Vegetarian or Non-Vegetarian. Each and every argument can be disproved. Certain things I know that non-veg causes diseases which can be prevented. Let's analyze the behavioral consideration. He gave certain arguments. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. I agree with him to a certain level. The food we eat has an effect on our behavior. That's the reason we Muslims have the flesh of herbivorous animal like goat, sheep, who are docile and peace-loving. We want to be peace-loving and docile. We don't have the meat of the carnivorous animal like lion, tiger, dog, pig, etc. And the Prophet clearly says all these animals are prohibited. We are peace-loving people. Therefore, we want to have animals which are peaceful. And countering argument, you all eat plants and you all behave like plants. That is suppression of the senses. A lower species. I know scientifically it is wrong. I'm only behaving like a lawyer. I feel ashamed to speak these points as a medical doctor. It's not true that you eat plants, you behave like plants. But the argument he has put forth, I'm giving a counter reply. You eat plants and you behave like plants, weak and suppressed, can't move properly. I'm sorry. I really apologize. I apologize. I have to reply to the arguments. I apologize if I've hurt the feeling of any vegetarian. It is not scientifically true. It's just an argument, a counter argument. Further, he gave the list of various peace-loving people like Mahatma Gandhi, and I respect Mahatma Gandhi because he has done certain good things for India and humanity. But if, because Mahatma Gandhi was peaceful, indicates that if you have veg food makes you peaceful, then today if you analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners for peace, almost all or most of them are non-vegetarian. Menachem Begin, non-veg. Yasser Arafat, non-veg. Anwar Sadat, non-veg. Mother Teresa, non-veg. Mother Teresa. I want to ask you a simple question. Which man in the history of humankind is known maximum for killing maximum human beings? Can you guess? Hitler! Adolf Hitler! He has killed 6 million Jews. Was he a non-veg or veg? Vegetarian! Anyhow, there are crusaders of vegetarians. You know, now on the internet if you go, they say, see, Adolf Hitler was a vegetarian is a myth. He sometimes had non-veg. And the other side says that, you know, when he had gastric problems, that time he had vegetable foods only. To tell you frankly, on a scientific viewpoint, I do not consider the diet of Hitler to be responsible for him killing 6 million Jews. Neither am I telling, irrespective whether you are a vegetarian or non-vegetarian, I'm not interested in knowing, because I, being a doctor, I know it doesn't carry any weight. There were other factors which influenced him to take this drastic step, which is totally inhumane, not the diet. There are various researches done. There have been researches in America on a group of students who are pure non-veg and on a group of students who are veg, pure veg. And they analyze that the group of students who were non-veg, they were less violent and they were more social. But it's a research. It's not a scientific fact. I will never use this as an argument to prove that non-veg food makes you peaceful. No. I'm a doctor, more of a doctor, as well as lawyer where required because I'm in a debate. There are researches, but these researches aren't scientific facts. Most of the statements what Mr. Rashmi Zaveri made, all were researches, not scientific facts. There is not a single authentic medical book which says that non-veg food in general should be prohibited. Not a single. All these are researches, like the research done by this person in America. Then they say that veg food makes a person intelligent. And he gave a list of great names. Albert Einstein and Isaac Newton, etc., etc. If we analyze the list of the Nobel Prize winners in all these years, majority were non-veg. Majority. And today, animal behavioral scientists, they say that the carnivorous animal should be more intelligent than the herbivorous animal in order to catch the prey. If he's not intelligent, how will he catch the prey? But anyway, I'm not going to use this as an argument, therefore non-veg food makes you intelligent, because these things don't actually affect a human being. The diet does affect a human being, but these arguments don't affect. These arguments don't affect. And all the other arguments given, they don't carry weight, actually. There are people who give examples that non-veg food makes you strong is a myth. It's a scientific fact mentioned in several medical books, authentic, that non-veg food is good for health. It does have disease also. You can prevent them. There are proteins, which I'll come to it later on. And to counter-argue that, they're giving an example of Yadunath Singh Naik. Has anyone heard of him? Yadunath Singh Naik. In the army, it is mentioned in this book, Vegetarian or Non-Vegetarian, Choose Yourself by Gopinath Agarwal. Yadunath Naik, being a vegetarian in the army, in wrestling, he defeated two non-vegetarians. Therefore, veg food makes you strong. I feel ashamed to reply to these arguments. I feel ashamed. It's a known fact that the title holders of world wrestling, yes, there are vegetarian wrestlers also, but if you compare with the full world, almost all the title holders of world wrestling are non-veg. The person known in bodybuilding maximum, who is he? Arnold Schwarzenegger, 13 times world titles he got. 7 as Mr. Olympia, 5 as Mr. Universe, and 1 as Mr. World. What was he, veg or non-veg? Non-veg. The boxer Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay, non-veg. Mike Tyson, non-veg. Yes, of course, non-veg food does add to the strength. That is a scientific fact. That's the reason that if you analyze, that when a person is convalescing from a disease, it's preferable non-veg food. Not that you have to have non-veg, it's preferable egg, etc. And I'll come to it later on. And then they give an example of a wrestler, Professor Ram Murthy. Never heard his name. He says it's a world famous wrestler. Who has heard of him? Anyone has heard of him? Professor Ram Murthy? No one. World famous. Where do you get this news from? World famous. Then they give the example of Paramjit Singh in London, pure vegetarian, who skips 2,000 times a day. Therefore, vegetarian food makes you an athlete. If these are the arguments supposed to be scientific, I really feel ashamed. Most of the athletic record holders, here's the Guinness book. You can go through it. I've brought it along here. All mentioned about bodybuilding, athletic, 100 meters dash, all these people, if at random also you check up their dietary history, even giving benefit of doubt, more than 80 to 90% will be non-veg. But I will be a fanatic if I say that all these records are only due to the diets. I'll be a fanatic. A few records may be related to the diet, but not all. For the argument they give that the smell and the sight of a carnivorous animal is strong. The night vision is strong. As Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri said, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivorous. In herbivorous, it is less. In human meat, it is less. Therefore, we should be vegetarian. There are herbivorous animals, like the bee, whose sense of smell is very strong. And they even have a very good night vision. See, these are arguments which are not scientific, may be useful in a debate to convince the people illogically. Therefore, I'm here. Then he gave the example. You know, animals have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice, the carnivorous animal. Herbivorous animal don't have coarse voice. And to ask a simple question, which animal is maximum known for a hoarse voice? Donkey. Veg or non-veg? Veg or non-veg? Veg. Anyway, by no means am I trying to prove that vegetarian food creates hoarse voice or non-vegetarian food creates melodious voice. If you see the list of singers, many are non-veg, many are veg also. So just by quoting singers who are veg saying, oh, that's why vegetarian diet makes you melodious, is all illogical arguments. Really, I feel ashamed to answer all these things. And he gave certain economic points, that economic reasons why we should have vegetarian food. It's more economical, according to Mr. Zaveri. And he gave several statistics, so many calories, so many this, so many tons of protein, which is mentioned here. From where they get the statistics, God alone knows. And he mentioned some protein. It's also mentioned in this book that 1 kg of animal protein that we get, we have to feed so many plants, etc. Therefore, it's equivalent to 7 kg of veg protein. So if you're having meat for 1 kg protein, you are taking 7 kg vegetables. Therefore, vegetable is cheaper. How they get this kg of protein, I being a medical doctor, don't realize. Is it kg of food or kg of protein? And if I agree with them, I agree with them. Okay. You say, for sake of argument, 2 + 2 = 5, I agree, and then ask you, let's see, take 2 rupees, give me 5 rupees. Take 2,000, give me 5,000. Similarly, if I agree it is right, all the statistics, then I tell that the vegetarians, they should thank the non-vegetarians. You know why? Because if we would not have slaughtered the animal for food, it would have lived for another 5 to 10 years. And in that time, you would have had the vegetables of 7 to 8 people for a few years. So you should thank us from preventing the animal from eating your vegetable food. Furthermore, he gave the calculation from some record, from where, I don't know. 1:14, the land that you graze required for animal is 14 times more than the land required for food, etc. Same example is given here that the land required to produce 1 ton of beef, the same land you can feed 5 average families. 1 ton of beef is equivalent to 10 or 20 tons of veg food. And the land required to graze an animal can raise 5 average families. My early argument also holds good here. But besides that, these ideological vegetarians, they fail to realize that the animals graze on land which is unsuitable for growing crops. They eat the plants which is inedible for the human beings, like husk and stalks, corn stalks. They don't eat plants which are edible for the human beings. Yes, they can eat. But when they enter the fields, the farmer, but natural, takes them out of the field. Why? To cause loss. Yes, if you have excess of crop, etc., there are certain governments who even feed them. And there are nomadic populations who make their living by grazing animals on land which is unsuitable for crop growing. but they eat the vegetation which is inedible to the human beings, and they make the living. Even the animal lives, even the human being lives. And today, according to UN report, about 23% approximately of the land in the world is used for pastures, 23% for forest, less than 10% for cultivation. The remaining 45% majority can yet be used for growing crops. Why don't you use that? Why are you running after the food of the animals, poor living creatures? Let them live, let them eat. Why are you stopping them from eating? If the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Overpopulation. I am aware that human beings, they raise animals for food. That means by methods, they increase the multiplication of the animals. But if suppose I agree that from today, all non-vegetarians stop raising animals for food and stop killing them for food, yet they will grow in population. You know why? Human beings. In all these years, our population is increasing. Even with all the family planning method, with all the birth control, hum do hamare do, yet we are increasing. There is no birth control method among the cattle, and the gestation is less than the human beings. 5 months to 6 months to 8 months, less than the human beings, and they multiply faster. So if we stop killing and stop raising, yet within a few decades, you'll have problems not of overpopulation of human beings, of overpopulation of cattle. How are you going to solve it? There are various nutrition. He talked about protein, etc. If time permits, I will speak in the rebuttal. I would like to make a statement of Dr. George R. Kerr, which is sufficient to counter all his arguments on health. Dr. George R. Kerr, he is a professor of nutrition in the University of Texas. Why I'm giving the designation, you can come to know that these people actually specialize in catching health fraud. People who deal in fraud in health. He says that virtually all authors of the diet and disease books, they propose hypotheses which are untested, ill-tested, unfound, unlikely, or disproved. I'd like to repeat. Dr. George R. Kerr says virtually all authors of books on diet and disease, they propose hypothesis which is ill-tested, unfound, non-tested, unlikely, or disproved. Time is running short. I would like to make the statement that's given by the American Council on Science and Health. Just a statement. See, they are experts. These quotations of research and scientific facts, all this quotation that this causes this disease, that, some are scientific facts, but they can be prevented. But the other thing about mentioning about this line and that line, these are only statistics done by individual researchers. Even when you do PhD, you can do a research and that will come into account, but won't carry weight. American Council on Science and Health says that a person need not abstain from meat and be a vegetarian to have a healthy diet. And the topic is not veg or non-veg, which is healthier. It is non-veg food permitted or prohibited for the human beings? And I will list out the points in summary to make it easier for Mr. Zaveri to answer in the rebuttal. Point number one, there is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. Point number two, geographical places like Arctic, where Eskimos live, how could you have provided food all these years back? And today also, if you provide, it's going to be more expensive. Point number three, if all life is sacred, why do you kill the plants? Even they have life. Point number four, even plants feel pain. Point number five, even if I agree they have two senses less, killing a creature of two senses less is a lesser crime, is illogical. Point number six, it's preferable to kill one animal and take one animal life than to take 100 lives of plants for feeding 100 people. Point number seven, each and every argument can be disproved. The liver and the kidney, HCl, same with saliva, same with the pH of the blood, same with the lipoprotein. Point number eight, Human beings have an omnivore set of teeth for eating veg as well as non-veg. Point number nine. They have a digestive system which can digest both veg and non-veg and have proved it, scientifically approved by the enzymes. Point number 10. Primitive man was non-veg. So you can't say it's prohibited for human beings, even for that person. Point number 11. The food you eat has an effect on your behavior, but saying that non-veg food makes you violent has got no scientific base at all. Point number 12, giving argument that veg food makes you strong, makes you peaceful, makes you intelligent, makes you athletes, are all myths. Point number 13, night vision and sense of smell is strong in carnivores. In herbivores, it is less. The carnivorous animal have hoarse voice, you know, coarse voice. Herbivorous animal don't have coarse voice. Are all illogical arguments. Point number 14, that veg food is cheaper, I've disproved it. It's not economical. In certain countries, yes. Like India, it can be. But if you go abroad, in the Western countries, veg food is more expensive. And fresh veg food is phenomenal. Fresh vegetables. Furthermore, point number 15, that the land required to graze the animal will cause scarcity of the land for growing crops is also wrong. Point number 16, if the non-vegetarians stop slaughtering the cattle, do you know that there will be overpopulation of cattle? Point number 17, according to Dr. Kerr, these books written by dietitian, they can't be relied upon. All the statistics given are mainly from there. There is not a single statement, point number 18, in any authentic medical book which says non-veg food in general should be banned. Point number 19, there is not a single government on the face of the earth which has banned all non-veg food as a general rule. And point number 20, that even the American Council on Science and Health has said that for a healthy diet, being a pure vegetarian is not required. These are sufficient proof, logical and scientific, that non-veg food has to be permitted. If Mr. Zaveri doesn't agree, I request him to answer scientifically, not by comparison on just researches. But yet if Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri doesn't reply to more than 20 points which I've put forth, yet I will not ask him to become a non-veg, because I'm not a fanatic non-vegetarian. I'm not. Yet if you want to continue eating vegetarian food, I have got no objection. It's a personal choice. It's a personal choice. Some people like, due to certain taste, etc. It's a personal choice. And only thing I'd like to tell the people, that the vegetarians, the ideological vegetarians who do so much propaganda that this has got more value, etc., they should stop such things and stop distributing these type of books which mislead the people. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 125, which says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah, wal ma'azatil hasna, wajadun billati ahsan." That is, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them, and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen.
Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious.
I now call upon Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri to present his response to Dr. Zakir Naik. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri.
First of all, I really thank Dr. Zakir Naik for giving me the choice whether I would like to still remain a vegetarian or non-vegetarian. Thank you very much. I would request Mr. Coordinator that would you like to have the rebuttal or my comments now, or shall we have?
No.
Because after all, you know, this is...
No. Now it's better, you know, we'll...
Let's have some question part. Answer, if you think.
Question answer we have in the third session. We have three-part session. Yes, Mr. Zaveri, you can continue.
Now, we are totally at the command of the coordinator, so I will obey.
As decided, you know, the same format we keep.
I will obey.
I will not allow Dr. Zakir also to change the format.
Now,
I'll object.
First thing that I will say, it's not a question of whether one is logical or illogical, and it's not a question of the choice that one makes. As I said in my talk earlier, everything is relative. And you have to understand this topic from that perspective. Now, one thing that I will very strongly object with respect to Dr. Zakir's, that not a single religion prohibits non-veg. I am expert, I can say, because I am a student, I have done MA in genealogy, I can say from my religious point of view that Lord Mahavir and our all 24 Tithankaras very vehemently prohibited non-veg food. I have already given you some quotations. You see, mainly arguments of Dr. Dean Ornish is based on the fact that non-veg food contains excessive protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. So that is why he said that for healthy and peaceful living, you must have non-veg veg diet. Now, he said that plant has also got life. No, it is not only proved by Dr. Jagdish Chandra Bose, but even our Lord Mahavir, he stated 2,500 years ago that not only plant, air, water, fire, minerals of the earth, they all have life. He has not said that you are allowed to kill this life and maintain yourself. But he was a practical Tirthankara, so he said that those who cannot renounce this world and become Jain Muni. You know, Jain Munis, they don't even kill plant vegetation or even other living beings for their food. They beg the food which is cooked in our house. We'll not go into that controversy that even you kill it and then give them. That's a separate story. But the teachings of Mahavir are very clear that you shall not harm any living being, whether animate or inanimate. Now, because of certain constraint for those people who cannot renounce the world, he has said that at least you can avoid essential killing. He has said that even if you, when you have food made out of plant, it is violence, it is hinsa, but it is necessary. So what I prohibit is unnecessary killing. Friends, this is a very sharp distinction, but very important distinction we should make, that if the alternative is available, we should not go for that alternative which compels us to kill and eat our own fellow creatures. Another thing, so he said plants. In my talk I stated about plant food, and he said that even a lizard can grow tail. That's the only exception. The plants, you pluck fruits, they will give you more fruits. You cut their branches, more branches will grow. See, there is no end to such argument. So let us restrict our argument to this. About medical science, and he rightly stated that medically also he has given certain things. I have also stated. Now it is for the enlightened audience to decide whether the scientific facts that I have given are correct or he has given. It's okay. It's a question of argument. Now he has conveniently forgotten. Please excuse me, I am telling because I am trying to rebut your things. The psychological aspect. When we consume animal food, we also inherit certain animal instincts. What have you to say? Please, in your rebuttal, you can say that. Now, doctors also, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetable. Now, coming to cooking, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetables for healthy diet. Only that food or cereals which will not be proper for a human being to consume raw, that only can be cooked. But as far as possible, and in our Indian Vegetarian Congress, we always, whenever we have a meeting, we have most of the food raw, uncooked, and that is more healthy, according to us. About the books, these books were not given by me to Dr. Naik, and it was given by my friend, Mr. Salecha, who approached me. That's okay, it's nothing very important. Now, I will tell you one thing, that you cannot alter the truth by just loud applause. Okay. If you are impressed by my argument, you may applaud me. Or if you are impressed by the other argument, you can applaud that. But I firmly believe that just because some arguments are appealing to you and you applaud them loudly will not alter the truth. And I have referred to about one book, Dr. Deepak Chopra. He has also written many books. He is also a physician, practicing physician, like Dr. Dean Ornish. He has also conducted researches. And he has come out with a theory that your food will have a terrific effect on your impulses and urges, your physical development, psychological development, and emotional development. You know, most of the psychological and emotional distortions are because of the flesh food that one eats, and that is why it is prohibited. It is totally illogical to say that by eating animals, you are helping vegetarians. We should not worry about the animal population because nature is quite capable of taking care. Why? Because we are rearing more animals for killing. That is why if we are not doing it, look at the jungle. Everywhere the natural cycle is there. Balancing will take care of itself. Nobody has to worry about it. Now, as per the history that Mr. Trivedi also referred, and also Dr. Zakir. Now I will tell from Jain historical point of view that in our Jain scriptures, it is mentioned very clearly that those persons who were living in prehistoric stage, they lived under a tree and they were sufficiently provided by trees. They did not have to go for any killing. Friends, I am of course given more time, but I really personally feel that let's not have a sort of dialogue or arguments between. I would like very much the audience to participate and have more time for question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Zaveri. We have 5 minutes more. It's taking 5 minutes left. Now I call upon Dr. Zakir Naik to present a response to Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri. For 15 minutes only.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Ala Rasulillah wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wa qul jaal haqq wa zaqal batil. Innal batila kana zahuka. Nunazzilu minal qur'ana ma huwa shifaa'un wa rahmatul mu'minin wa la yazidu dhalimin illa khasara. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. The respected people on the dais, and my respected elders, and my brothers and sisters, I welcome once again all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. I have not conveniently forgotten anything. If you realize I spoke maybe half minute more than the time allotted, so how can you say I conveniently forgot? If you give me even 5 hours more, if you're willing to stay. Because you are the person who kept time restrictions. You know, less time 30. I had to bargain for 15 minutes. I would love to speak for 2 hours. Even full day, I can do it. Because I'm a marathon speaker. Alhamdulillah. I'm a non-vegetarian.
Mr. Zaveri said that I said that no religion prohibits non-veg. I never said no religion. I said no major religion. It's being recorded. No major religion. And Jainism is not a major religion. According to the books you gave me, you gave certain books, Jain is only 0.4% of India, 0.4. Less than 1%. Can you call it a major religion? In India, leave aside world. World out of the question. Negligible. I am very clear cut in my statement. Regarding the argument on Jainism, I can reply, but the coordinator won't give me permission. I'm restricted to Islam. You know, I can reply even on Jainism. I'm a student of comparative.
Excuse me, sir, you can't interfere when the speaker is speaking.
Well, they're saying, I did not say, you can very well see the video cassette. There is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. You can see the video cassette.
And ask your question in question time, please.
Don't get irritated. The diet will help you. Don't get irritated. Brother Rashmibhai Zaveri said, I did not answer whether you get animal instinct. I said in my lecture, I think you didn't hear, I said we eat peaceful animals like goat, sheep, because we want to be peaceful. And therefore, when I came starting, I always said, peace be on all of you. Further, he said, I didn't state Dr. Dean Onish. I yet challenge him. If his book is referred by any authentic medical college, authentic book, not just dietary books, that answer I already gave by Dr. William T. Jarvis. Even scientists and medical professionals are not immune to the ideological thinking of the vegetarians. They aren't immune. It's not a medical book. He may have written a diet book. I am very clear in my words. I don't mix words. And Dean Onish, whatever his name is, may be very famous. I don't know him. I'm hearing him for the first time. I don't know. I yet ask him to prove and check whether that book is referred as a textbook. Not as a medical book, a text medical book in a college. That shows authenticity. He said, we should not worry about the cattle. Nature will take care. It is you all who are so much worrying. We aren't worrying. Nature made them in such a way that the moment you kill them, they will again come. God is the creator. Allah made them. If we kill lion, tiger, they will become extinct. Therefore, we cannot have their food. The cattle, we can have. God has made them that way. If we don't follow the instruction of God, there will be overpopulation. And regarding cutting of plants, what he said, you know, people say that if you have plants, the mother is yet alive. So in that way, the offspring of the cow, of the goat, the calves, that means can we cut them? Yes. The mother is yet alive. The cow is yet alive. And when the offspring becomes a mother, you can also kill the mother. So even if I agree with this logic, the plant survives. In the animals, more lives are surviving than the plants, if I agree with this logic. Furthermore, I said that best is prevention is better than cure. I agree with Dr. Onish when he says that, you know, vegetarian diet is helpful for certain diseases. Even I advise that. Where did I say no? But the topic is not which food is healthier. But making a statement, it is banned for human beings. I challenge any authentic medical book. I'm a doctor, not books, whether given by Russia Foundation or Indian Vegetarian Congress, whatever it is. These books are stating things which are unfound, ill-tested, unproved. There is an Islamic method of prevention better than cure, which will answer most of your questions. The Islamic method is there of prevention better than cure. When we slaughter the animal, we do the zabiha. We cut the throat and the windpipe and the vessels of the neck without damaging the spinal cord. Otherwise, the nerve going to the heart may get severed. There may be cardiac arrest. When the spinal cord is not damaged and the vessels of the neck are slit open along with the throat and the windpipe, the heart is pumping. Most of the blood flows out of the body. Blood is a very good media of germ and bacteria. If you slaughter the animal in this way, most of the disease transmitted by blood, many which you named, can be eliminated, can be prevented. The meat remains fresh for a longer time if it's slaughtered by the Islamic method. And people say, oh, it's so merciless. You know, y'all are so mercilessly killing, it dies of pain. When we slaughter in the Islamic method, when we cut the blood vessels of the neck, the blood supply going to the nerve, which is responsible for pain, is severed. So the animal does not feel pain. The animal kicks and writhes. You know why? Due to the gush of flow. The animal doesn't feel pain. It is contracting and relaxing because there's lack of blood in that part of the body. The animal does not die of pain. It dies a painless death. Painless. Painless. We eliminate most of the disease transmitted by blood. Secondly, there are many countries in the world and many people who raise animals. They give them hormones. And one was mentioned by Mr. Zaveri, the name. It's called as DES, diacetylbisterol. It's a hormone injected to cattle so that they become fat and you get more money for flesh. This is haram in Islam. Carcinogenic hormones, if ingested in animal, even if you slaughter by the zabia method, it is yet haram. It is zabia but not halal. It is zabia and haram. If the cattle are injected with hormones, you are not allowed to have those hormones. Neither are we allowed to have cows which are fed with non-veg. Because the Prophet said, any animal that is fed with non-veg, it is prohibited for you. After that, if you take care of hygienic conditions and cook the meat very well, most of the diseases which Mr. Zaveri spoke of, not all, most of them will be eliminated. And in the non-veg flesh food, the most dangerous, which is commonly eaten, is pork. It has more than 70 different diseases which you can get if you ingest pork. More than 70 different diseases. And is ischemic heart disease, which he spoke about. Because pork has more of fat-building material than muscle-building material, it gets deposited on the walls of the vessels, causing atherosclerosis, hypertension, etc. That's the reason in the Quran, no less than four different places, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173, in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145, and Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115, it says, "Hurrimat alaykumul maitutu waddamu walahmul khinzir, wama uhilla li ghairillah bih." Forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides God's name has been invoked. It's haram. So we abstain from it and we prevent several diseases of non-veg. Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 81, "Eat of the food we have provided for you in sustenance, but commit no excesses therein." Most of the diseases, what Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri spoke about, is due to excessive eating. Even if you eat excessive veg food, you will have many diseases. I will not say, don't have veg food. I'm a doctor. I'm not an ideological, neither a fanatic non-vegetarian. So if you prevent eating in excess, most of the disease will be prevented. If you follow the Islamic guidelines, slaughter in the Islamic method, remove the blood, don't give hormones, cook the food very well, hygienic conditions, avoid pork, don't eat in excess, most of the disease can be prevented. It answers most of his arguments. Few are yet remaining. If time permits or during question answer time, if you ask, I will reply. Do you know that talking about healthy food, talking about all research and experiments, I'll talk something which is a fact. According to Dr. William, again, very famous person, Dr. William, he says that vegetarian food extends the life of a human being for more than 6 years. If you have veg food, as compared to non-veg food, you live 6 years longer. Again, hypothesis. If you analyze, a data was collected about all the people who lived above 100 years from 1932 to 1952. And on this data, a person by the name of O. Cigares, he wrote a book, Living to be 100, 1,200 people who did and why they did it. Everything is mentioned. In it, even diet is mentioned. Do you know out of 1,200 people, how many were vegetarian? How many? Guess. 1,000. Four. This survey wasn't done to prove veg food or non-veg food. It was done for other reasons, but even the diet was mentioned. It's a fact. It's not a research. It's a fact. Out of 1,200 people who lived in the span of 20 years, over 100 years, only four were vegetarian. You know alcohol? Alcohol alone, it is a veg diet or not? Alcohol is veg or non-veg? Veg, from juices or fruits. And the disease that are caused by alcohol alone is more than all the non-veg disease put together. One vegetable diet. So just for alcohol, I cannot say that all vegetable foods should be banned. Today, scientists, and he'll agree, it's mentioned in these books also, the cause of maximum death in the world today is alcohol, number one. So I don't ban all veg food. What do I say? As Quran says, Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya yuladin amanu, innamal khamru al maisuru, wal anzabu al aslamu, rishtu minamali shaitan, fashtanibu lalakum taflihun. That, oh, you believe? Verily, intoxicants and gambling and idol worship and dedication of stones and divination of arrows, these are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper. Alcohol is a Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it. I only prohibit alcohol, not all veg food. And smoking. Second greatest cause of death in the world. Veg or non-veg? Veg. Can you prevent the alcoholic disease? Only way you can prevent is de-fermented. It ceases to be alcohol. Can you prevent smoking disease? Don't have tobacco. Only option is prohibition. If there is no prevention, then comes the question of prohibition. So alcohol is prohibited. There are more than 400 fatwas by Islamic scholars. Smoking is prohibited because there's no prevention. You know kesari dal? Kesari dal? Indian government has banned it. It causes spastic paraplegia. Staple food of Northwest Indians. Banned. Why? It causes death also. Spastic paraplegia. Alcohol. Many countries have banned, including Saudi Arabia, including states in India have banned it. Smoking in Singapore is banned in public places, in government places, in public transport. Kesari dal banned by India. If there's no prevention, then you can ban it. I do not know of a single government that has banned all non-veg food in general. Not a single. Yes, few non-veg food, like pork, Saudi Arabia has banned. There's no prevention, ban it. If there's no prevention, then you prohibit it. And the debate was not which is better, which is healthier, veg or non-veg. The debate was, is non-veg food permitted or prohibited? I gave a list of more than 20 points. So I can very well say that Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri conveniently stopped his talk 5 minutes before not to answer these things. If you give me 1 hour more, I will continue speaking. Wild berries, they're poisonous. Strychnine, vegetable food, they're poisonous. Datura, poisonous. What's the solution? Don't have it. You know, water. Water has so many diseases transmitted. Cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid. It causes amoebiasis, giardiasis, roundworm, pinworm, vile hepatitis. I can go on talking. Only by water. What do you do? Do you ban water? You prevent it. You purify the water. The disease will be prevented. You know milk. Milk has so many diseases. Shigella, cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid, tuberculosis, salmonellosis, brucellosis. I can go on listing. What do you do? Do you ban milk? What do? You pasteurize it. You don't ban it. You don't prohibit it. It's unmedical. Whether milk is non-veg or veg is a debatable topic. I won't argue on that. So if you cannot prevent the disease, then do you prohibit it? I have given various reasons, which Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri hasn't replied. There's not a single government who has banned non-veg food in general. There's not a single major religion which has banned non-veg food in general. Therefore, I say that non-veg food is permitted, not prohibited. If I've heard the feelings of any vegetarians while giving the replies to the speaker, I sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart. I would like to end the talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 81, which says, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَاكَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُكَ. When truth is heard against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. وَآخْرُ دَعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
Now we begin the open question and answer session. To extract maximum benefit in the limited time that we have available in the question and answer session, we expect the following rules to be observed. Your question should be on the topic only, that is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Questions out of the topic will not be permitted. Kindly state your question briefly and to the point. This is not a lecture time, neither a cross-question time for the questioners. I repeat, kindly state your question briefly and to the point. This is not a lecture time, neither a counter question time for the questioners. Mr. Zaveri and Dr. Zakir should answer comprehensively, and each answer should not exceed 5 minutes. 4 mics have been provided in the auditorium, 2 next to the stage for the gents, and 2 in the rear central aisle for the ladies. If you wish to put a question to Mr. Zaveri, kindly queue up behind the mic with the name clip, question for Mr. Zaveri, similarly so in the ladies. And if you wish to put a question to Dr. Zakir, kindly queue up behind the mic with the name clip, question for Dr. Zakir. Only 1 question at a time may be asked. For your second question, you would have to go right at the back of the queue again and await your second chance. Written questions on slip papers, which are available from the volunteers in the aisles, would be given secondary preference if time permits. On your slip where you're putting your question, kindly tick or write to whom your question is addressed, Mr. Zaveri or Dr. Zakir, or it might be put aside. Kindly state your name and profession before putting forward your question so that the speakers would be in a better position to answer you. We would allow 1 question on each of the mics in a clockwise rotation, alternately addressed to each speaker. May we have the first question from the mic on my left? So we have first gents, ladies two, then gents again. Yes, brother, we can have the first question from you. That's for Mr. Zaveri.
Yeah.
Yes.
Respected Chief Guest and Mr. Zaveri, my question is, you have spoken non-vegetarian is prohibited from various angles, and you have spoken about your Lord Mahavir. Mahavir advised that killing animals and living happy at the expenses of others is prohibited. Now please explain to me, did Mahavir say that can you eat vegetarian in the sense, I mean, Mahavir never go and cut trees and have vegetable foods. He was always sitting under the tree, and the food which he has eaten is mostly fruits which has fallen from the tree. He was not plucking up the fruits and ate. So please explain to me, because you have spoken on the subject of this, non-vegetarian is prohibited for the thing. And please explain to me what is the Jain view, because your idea is the what okay. Mahavir said. What
please,
Mahavir said.
I have understood your question.
Yeah,
I will reply. See, what Lord Mahavir stated, that even plant has got life. And he says that even eating vegetable food is, as per the Jain scriptures, is prohibited for Jain Muni. But because of constraint, everybody cannot become a Jain Muni. That is why he said that at least the unnecessary killing of animals should be avoided. He never said that eating of plant food is allowed even for Jain Munis.
Yes, sister. Question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Zakir. I'm Humaima here. I have a question. There are various pamphlets distributed by a vegetarian society quoting the Quran from Surah Hajj that it is not the meat nor the blood that reaches Allah, but your piety that reaches Him, thus proving that Islam prohibits killing of animals for fowl. There are many quotations from Quran and Hadith showing concern for animals.
I would like to thank the sister. She has asked a very fundamental question, that there are certain pamphlets distributed by organizations proving from the Quran and Hadith that non-veg food a Muslim should not have, it is prohibited. And this was the initiation of this debate. I didn't touch on it because, you know, they told me to keep out of religion. But since it's a question, I'm compelled to answer. This was a pamphlet that the president of Rusha Foundation, Mr. Dhanraj Salesha, he gave, and how this debate was initiated. He gave this pamphlet quoting from the Quran. I'll just give also reference. The reference is a bit wrong out there, but I don't catch on to the reference. He's quoting a verse from Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 37, which says that it is not their meat nor their blood which reaches Allah, which reaches God, but it is your piety that reaches Him. And I agree with that totally. It's indicating that Islam is not like certain other religions which believe that Almighty God requires blood and meat to survive. It's saying that when you sacrifice, blood doesn't reach God, meat doesn't reach God. It is your intention. It is the righteousness. It's the piety with which you sacrifice. Allah considers that piety. That is the reason when we sacrifice in Eid al-Zuha, minimum one-third portion of that animal has to be given compulsory to the poor people. One-third can be given to friends and relatives. And maximum one-third you can keep for personal use. There is no part kept for Almighty God. Because Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6, verse 14, that He feedeth everyone but does not require to be fed. Allah Almighty God feeds everyone. He doesn't require to be fed. This verse is clear that when you sacrifice, Allah sees your intention. He doesn't require blood and meat of the animal. There's one more quotation. There are various. It will take me 1 hour to reply to all. I'll just pick up the second quotation of Quran, the two Quranic quotation. It says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 205, that when they turn away, they create mischief through the land by destroying crops and cattle. Allah loves not those who make mischief. After giving this quotation, below it's mentioned that therefore you should not have non-veg. The interpretation. The Arabic word used is nasal, which some have translated as cattle. It actually means progeny. But irrespective whether nasal you translate as cattle or progeny, if you read the context, those people who create mischief throughout the world by destroying crops and cattle or progeny, not slaughtering for food, destroying for creating mischief. Allah does not like those who make mischief. So if you kill any animal, even the plant if you kill, for making mischief, Allah doesn't like. If you say this verse refers to not having for food, that means you should not even have the crops. If I agree with you, this verse refers not to have cattle, even crops is there. It is a very wrong way of argument. They don't do self-analysis. Crop is also mentioned there. If they say by this verse, non-veg is prohibited, even veg is prohibited, it is not. Neither non-veg is prohibited, neither veg is prohibited. Certain foods which Allah has prohibited is mentioned in the Quran. The others Allah says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 168, eat of the good food we have provided for you. Regarding animal concern. Yes, there are various hadith. If you read Sahih Bukhari volume number 3, hadith number 551, and Sahih Bukhari volume number 8, hadith number 38, it speaks about a man who gave water to a thirsty dog. And Prophet said, he'll be rewarded. So people asked, do you even have reward for giving water to a thirsty dog? The Prophet said, yes. For every kind act you do to the animal, you will be rewarded. Imagine in the days of ignorance, Yom al-Jahiliya, 1400 years ago, where human beings were treated like animals, our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke about animal rights. Prophet said, don't overload the animals. You know, today in India, two bullocks are supposed to carry by law not more than 500 kgs. They carry more than a ton. Prophet said, don't overload them. Don't ill-treat them. Don't tie them and shoot them. Mentioned Sahih Muslim. Volume number 3. Hadith number 4812. It's also mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. Don't tie the animal and shoot them. It's mentioned in Sahih Muslim. Volume number 3. Hadith number 4810. That when you slaughter the animal, see to it that the knife is sharp so that the animal doesn't feel pain. Don't slaughter one animal in front of the other. Don't kill the animal twice. He said that, you know, adrenaline is released. It is released in the blood goes out of the body. Prophet spoke about animal concern. We should protect the rights. But for food, if it's lawful animal, you can have it. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, sister.
It's mentioned in the book, 100 Facts About Egg. On page number 8 and 9, fact number 13. Ethiopians are of the view, if a pregnant woman eats eggs, her child would be born bald-headed and would be deficient in reproduction. It's also mentioned in fact number 18. Some African countries believe that if a child is given to eat egg before teething, he may become mentally retarded. Are these scientific facts or are these superstitions? If you say these are scientific facts, then could you please prove it authentically? And if you say it's superstition, then why are you promoting falsehood by such books? That's 100 facts about egg. Thank you.
Thank you, sister. One thing, I have not written that book. Second thing, I have not given that book to you, and I have not referred to anything from that book. So it is not necessary to answer particularly for that book, but I can definitely say, which I have already touched upon in my subject, because egg contains excessive protein and cholesterol and saturated fat, that is why it is not healthy for any human being, and particularly for pregnant women and children.
Yes, the next question from the mic on the right.
I am Fazal Sarang. By profession, I am an architect. My question is to Mr. Dr. Zakir Naik. Is the non-vegetarian food is the only reason for the heart disease?
The brother asked a very good question. That is non-veg the only reason for the heart disease? And this was spoken by Mr. Zaveri, that flesh, animal flesh, chicken, mutton, beef causes heart disease. It can cause, he's right. And he further said, there is not a single vegetable source which contains cholesterol. If you tell that to any doctor, not the ideological vegetarian, they'll agree. Heart disease is caused when the diet contains more fat and more cholesterol, irrespective whether it's veg or non-veg. Irrespective. Non-veg. Foods do contain high cholesterol. But even vegetable foods, groundnut oil, cashew nut, coconut, ghee, butter, all this, even a common housewife knows. You know why? There are ads in the media. Half safola oil will not cause heart disease. Indicating the other oils cause heart disease. Simple. You don't have to be a doctor. It's a blatant 100% falsehood. I, being a medical doctor, I challenge Mr. Rashmibhai to answer, does butter contain fat or not? And the doctors do tell the people suffering from heart disease, don't have fat, don't have butter, don't have groundnut oil, don't have cashew nut oil. So where did you get this idea from? From these books. This book he gave to me. Correct? This book you gave to my brother. Who gave? Mr. Salesha. Mr. Salesha gave this book. In this book also it is mentioned the same thing, that there is no cholesterol in vegetables. I'm sorry if I thought, because the first time I'm meeting Mr. Zaveri here, if he didn't give these books, I apologize. But one thing, that all these books are published by Jain organizations, you know, and distributed in Bombay, cheap, cheap. Yes, I'm not
please,
blaming.
Please,
I don't want to hurt
let
anyone's
Let us not
feeling.
Have a dialogue across the this thing.
I'm not going to hurt anyone's feeling. I'm sorry, I didn't want to say that, but I was compelled. I don't want, if it's not, you said not written by Jain, it's not written.
No, you said, Dr. Zakir, that I should reply.
You will have a chance, sir, in your question answer time.
Sir, I'll let you allow you time. You know, in your time, you can respond back. No, I'll allow you to respond back anything you want in your time.
And I request the chairman to give me half minute more. I will disturb half minute more.
No, he's too smart. We'll not give him half minute more.
See, because so many allegations. Egg. You told egg is the cause. Egg does contain cholesterol. It's rich in cholesterol. But it's not the major cause. Today's research and medical books also say that the cholesterol in the egg is not the major villain, it is the saturated fat in which you fry the egg, butter, ghee, lard, pork, which is the main villain. If you don't have this frying in ghee, butter, the less chances of having ischemic heart disease by egg. And today, amongst the population, 2/3 of the population are non-responders to cholesterol. The moment there's high intake of cholesterol, like taking egg, the liver immediately cuts its own production. And the level that reaches the blood is the same. There are 1/3 people who are responders to cholesterol. They have a problem. They should abstain from yolk of the egg. Otherwise, even if you have one or two eggs a day, you will not have heart diseases. And if you have it with bacon, with pork, then the problem. If you fry in ghee, you'll have a problem. If you fry in groundnut oil, you'll have a problem. Causing baldness. I don't want to give examples. Even if you check here, there are many people who are bald. There are great philosophers who are bald. I don't want to take their names. I don't want to hurt your feelings. So this thing is just a research which is based on illogical assumption. A research should be practical. And the associate factor for heart disease is also alcohol as well as smoking. These two are also one of the associate causes for heart diseases. Yes, in America, heart disease are more non-veg because they are fats. Quran says don't have an excess, this problem will be solved. Secondly, the vegetarians of America, they are fluent. It's a woke to be a vegetarian because, you know, to buy veg food is expensive. If you retire in Mercedes car, you have status. If you have veg food, it is status there. About 3 to 7% are vegetarian in America. Less than 1% are pure vegetarian. Less than 1%. Because they are fluent and they are rich, they take more care of hygiene. And many vegetarian ideologically also, like even Mr. Rashmibhai, Zaveri may agree that alcohol is prohibited, smoking is prohibited. Because of associated factors, the case of heart disease in vegetarian is less. But anyone who has food which is rich in cholesterol or fat, irrespective whether it is veg or non-veg, he will have heart disease. To prevent it, follow the guidance in the Quran in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 81, that do not commit excesses. That reminds me of a story. In school, we had learned that there was a religious priest who ate excessive food, and he had 64 laddus. And when he came back, his wife said, that why don't you have furan chutki, some digestive? So he says, Are baoli akal nahi banke che bachcho ki mata, agar churan chutki ke liye jagah hoti, to main do laddu aur na bhok leta.
Brother, the question is directed to Mr. Rashmi Zaveri. This is a book I've come across, which is named Meat Eating 100 Facts. Please, sir, this is not concerning
you may,
to you.
You I'm may put your question. Saying one book writes like that rather than saying this person's book or that. You say this book states so and so, that would be acceptable.
Okay, here is a book from Jain publication. You being a Jain, I'm asking you a question. Which is, the name is Meat Eating 100 Facts, written by Dr. Nemi Chand. And it gives a cartoonic representation of meat eating people, which I feel it's very insulting and it's degrading, defaming. So I just want to ask you, in this Jains being tolerant, is it fair enough for Jains to publish such books which can hurt people's feeling? It's mockery, Please answer.
Yes, the speaker would not like to answer to that. I give him the full right not to answer to a question which a speaker feels is
but
not
I'm
suitable.
Just asking about
we will allow the second question. Will. The speaker.
The question of
okay,
being
the
tolerant.
Next question, please, for the... He passes that answer. He would not like to respond.
I'm not satisfied.
See, the speakers have a right. I would request the questioners not to get worried or agitated in any sort. The speakers have a full right not to respond, or if you feel your question is not right or not suitable for them, they have a right not to respond back. Kindly note. So put your question and frame it in such a way that it is not vulgar. Neither derogatory, and yes, so it should not be derogatory to the speaker or to a particular faith. Put it in a factual manner. This is what stated. What is your opinion? Don't give your comment in a derogatory manner. Ask, what do you say about this? Yes, don't give your opinion. Let the speaker give their opinion on the subject. Yes, sister. The next question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. My name is Azra. I would like to ask, in a book promoting vegetarianism by Gopinath Agarwal, on page 15th and 16th, he says that the milk a cow gives in its lifetime can satisfy 90,000 persons at one time. But the same cow is killed for flesh can satisfy 1,000 persons at one time. The same applies for goat also. He says killing the goose that lays a golden egg daily is never a wise proposition. Do you agree with him?
The sister asked a question again from the same book. And I would like to make a clarification. Mr. Salechar, he gave these books and said you can have more books, the letter is there if you want. And these books are available in various marketplaces. People are bound to buy, etc. That's right. Therefore, I'm requesting the people. That's right. That's right. The brothers asked, why am I repeating? Because all the arguments are mentioned here. These arguments, if it's not mentioned here, I wouldn't have repeated it.
Please, I think your tempers must be calm. What Mr. Zaveri said very correctly, book is written by somebody else. It is he who should try to defend the book. Mr. Zaveri doesn't want to defend the book. So let us forget the book and ask all questions which are pertaining to the talk.
Correct. And I agree with it. Mr. Zaveri read from books. He didn't do a research. He read books with speaking against non-vegetarian. He read books and he presented the fact. Either I accept it or I say the fact is wrong. I can't say because I didn't write the book, no one can ask me questions. That's illogical. If you ask me any questions pertaining to non-veg food, I either say the book is false or I say that it's illogical or it's logical. Why do you have to get irritated? It's a book promoting vegetarianism. If someone gets me a book against Islam, I will say that book is false.
Excuse me, I don't allow a debate between the audience and the speaker. The audience just put the question. The speaker can only answer the question. Don't get involved. I will not allow Dr. Zakir, neither Mr. Zaveri to get involved in any debate with the audience. This is not a debate time for the audience. Kindly note. You can continue with the answer.
I'm going to start with the answer. You can start the timing also. If I'm going to be interrupted every time, I want to give a complete answer. I would request the chairperson not to be biased towards one person only. If they're interrupting my answer, I have to be given time. And sister raised an argument, which is there not only in this book, even other books on internet. You go to the internet, the same argument is given. First thing is milk veg or non-veg is a big question. There are vegetarians who say that milk is non-veg. This book. I'm not blaming the speaker. This book, again, says milk is non-veg. If you have milk, so many diseases. Other vegetarian foundations say, no, we are lacto-vegetarian, we have milk. Whether milk is non-veg or veg, my simple question is, if you don't want to hurt the animals, when you milk the animal, it causes severe pain. You know, artificial milking of animal causes pain. You ask a breastfeeding woman, certain times she has problems, and she has to extract milk artificially, it is so painful. So when you extract milk from the animal, it's painful. When you don't agree that animals are meant for food, how can you milk the animals, the cattle and the cow? It is so painful. It is nothing but robbing the animal. If you say the animal is not meant for food, and if you have the milk of that animal, you're robbing the milk which is meant for the offsprings, for the calves. And the example that was given, that a cow, on average, in a day gives 10 kgs of milk. Again, this book. If it's wrong, no problem. It's on the internet also. 10 kgs of milk in a day. In a month, 300 kgs. In a year, about 3,000 kg. Do you calculate milk in kgs? In liters. Why in kgs? I don't know. Ask the author. And then further it says that 3,000 kgs of milk, it will feed 6,000 people. So in full lifetime, it will feed 90,000 people at one time. And the cow, if you kill, only 1,000 people. Which is better, 90,000 or 1,000? Why are you killing the goose that's laying the golden egg daily? It's not a wise proposition, and I agree with that. But the point to be noted is that no milkman will ever give a milking cow to the slaughterhouse. No slaughterhouse will ever purchase a milking cow because a milking cow is multiple times more expensive than a cow which has passed its age of milking. In Bombay, it costs 20 to 25,000 rupees milking cow. An old cow which has crossed the milking age cost only 3,000 to 5,000 rupees. So, what we do, we non-vegetarians, the cattle, we look after it till the time it gives milk. After it starts giving milk, we slaughter it. We take all the eggs of the goose. When it stops laying, we slaughter the goose for its flesh. Saab bhi mare aur lathi bhi na toote. Two birds with one stone. We are more intelligent. Again, the argument giving Let's see, some animals, you can use them in field, etc. You can use them for plowing, for transportation. If you love the animals so much, why do you overload them? And furthermore, the Indian statistics tells us that out of the population of cows, oxen, and bull, only 25% are productive. The remaining 75% are unproductive, either past the age of milking or they are males, all non-females, bulls, oxes. Now, what will you do with the 75% of excess non-productive cow, goat, bulls, ox? One option, you rear them up yourself. An average bull or cow requires 18,000 a year for living, according to the statistics. Their statistics, not my statistics. 18,000 a year. So after they give milk, they live another 4 or 5 years. Which farmer will bear the burden of millions of cow every year, 18,000? Second option is give to Jivdaya organization. They leave it open, it enters the field, eats up the crop. Third option, leave them in the jungle, animal will kill them. The last option is best, after they reach the age of milking, utilize the milk, give it to slaughterhouses, it benefits the farmer, he gets some money, and even the animal benefits the human being by eating the meat of the animal, as well as his hide for leather, as well as the bones. Hope that answers the question.
Next question for Mr. Zaveri.
According to Kasturi Chand Jain, in the marriage of the 22nd Tirthankar, Aris Nemi, popularly known as Neminath, meat of animals and birds was served. And both the bride and the bridegroom, according to Shastra, were Jains. Another incident was quoted that Chhelna, a Jain Shravika who was the wife of Bhimsar Shrenik, a contemporary of Mahavir, was pregnant. And she had the desire to eat the heart of her husband. Bhimsar's eldest son, Abhay Kumar, instead gave her some meat of a dead animal, and Chhelna, thinking it to be her husband's heart, ate it. I don't know how authentic is this article and whether what Kastur Chand said is true or false. What is its explanation? Please explain. I'm referring to the article from the Caravan series, December 1981.
Thank you, sister. First of all, I will request the coordinator to only allow those questions coming out of my talk, not out of any other book or another references for which I am not responsible. But because I am a true Jain, I know definitely about the Jain history, about Neminath Tirthankar. Yes, it is true. That is why he propagated that the killing of, that is exactly why he renounced the world, that for my marriage, are you going to sacrifice all these innocent creatures? No, I don't want such a feast for me. And that is why he became a Jain Muni and ultimately a Tirthankar. So that is why I can say that all Jain Tirthankaras have absolutely, in absolute terms, have prohibited non-veg food. Thank you. And please restrict your questions to my talk only, not because it seems, I don't know, it seems that these books were given in all good faith, that they should understand our viewpoint. It seems that they are all distributed to those people and they are now asked to ask questions. I don't think that is fair. You can ask me any question from my talk. I will be very happy to say.
Any question can be asked on the topic. The thing is there, whether it's in the talk or out
I
of
don't
the talk
mind.
The
that
speakers,
is okay.
Not necessarily the
and another point I will tell any Mr. Coordinator that Mr. Y.P. Trivedi and myself, we both have got other meetings, so we would like to conclude within 5 minutes.
What I would suggest, see the time given to both the speakers to speak was 50-50 minutes, then 15-15 minutes was for response, then we would have a question answer session for 50 minutes. If any of the speakers would like to forfeit the time of not carrying on with the question session, and if they have an emergency, I would excuse them, but I would continue the question answer session for 50 minutes because that has what been the chart given to me. I have to execute it like I had been told. Dr. Zakir cannot in his talk or response speak on any other religion. Forcefully got him not to speak on it. I'm telling you, forcefully I had to convince him you cannot touch anything else. I got him convinced because that was the request, his respect. Now, what both speakers have agreed to, I have followed that. Anything which both speakers don't agree, I've thrown it out. Let me be very clear. we have said 50 minutes, we'll allow 50 minutes, but if one speaker would like to leave early for any emergency or any requirement, a person has got a full free will and a choice. I would respect that requirement, but we'll continue question answer for 50 minutes. I've written down the time, 12:45, close down at around 1:30. Right? So I think that is being very fair and clear on my part. The next question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, Zakir bhai. My name is Khan Abdul Sami, and my question to you is, food value charts are distributed by vegetarians showing that the proteins and iron content of vegetarian food is higher than non-veg food. And thus they say veg food is more nutritious than non-food. Your comments, please. Thank you.
So, brother asked a very good question. I would like to reply to the question posed by the learned speaker also. He doesn't know who distributed them. It's given in writing out here. It's given by Rushabh Foundation to IRF saying, we would be pleased to give you more such material in huge quantities if you like the same to be circulated among Muslim brothers in Mumbai. Free of charge, huh? The brother has asked a question that there are fruit charts being distributed. Yes, even we get in a foundation. We didn't respond, saying that it's not worth responding. It's not worth responding. But when the request came from the Rushabh Foundation, are you willing? I reluctantly agreed, you know, it is not a topic of scientific thing. It's a well-known fact. He said, yes, we'll debate. I said, fine. So I'm here, just replying. Why should people get irritated? If you can quote me from any book, as long as it's within the topic, I will, inshallah, answer. If I don't know, I will say I don't know. If I know, I will say no. I know your question. And when I got that chart, it gives food value chart, saying that protein among the veg food is more than non-veg food. And even Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri in his talk, he said that the value of proteins, the quantity is more. Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri said that there were only three essential amino acids. You ask any doctor, it is not three, it is eight. No wonder five is lacking. It is eight essential amino acids which are not synthesized in the body. The remaining are synthesized. These essential amino acids should be given by the external food source. The proteins of animal foods, the biologically complete, known as higher protein, because they contain all the eight essential amino acids. The veg protein are lacking in one or more of the essential amino acids. It's a scientific answer. So even though the value may be more, 20 up, 10 down, it is not complete. The veg protein, the incomplete protein of lesser quality, animal protein is of higher quality and complete protein. Similarly, if you analyze, even the iron you get from the diet is of two types. One is heme iron, one is non-heme iron. Heme iron can be absorbed easily in the body. Non-heme iron cannot be absorbed easily. In the animal food, there is heme iron as well as non-heme iron. The vegetable food contains very little heme iron. Therefore, they cannot absorb. Therefore, there's more deficiency of iron in them. So even I agree with you, the iron content in figures may be high. The protein content may be higher. Down the conclusion is, veg food is more nutritive. It's misleading the people. It's nothing but misleading. I would call it in plain English, fraud. Who's doing it? Some vegetarian society. Misleading the people. And fraud is prohibited in every religion, small or big. Whether major or minor religion, fraud is prohibited. So, I would like to ask a question. Would you prefer taking 10 notes of rupees 20 or one note or rupees 500? If you have money, you choose the second. Hope that answers the question.
The next question for Mr. Zaveri.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Javed Sheikh. My question is to Rashmibhai. Rashmibhai, in your talk, you mentioned that diseases transmitted through meat, flesh to human beings. But plants also affected by some diseases, viral, bacterial diseases. So you can get diseases from plant, vegetarian food also. You also mentioned Dean Ornish and Deepak Chopra, references and recommendation of those doctors. If you believe in recommendations of doctors and medical professionals, Trivedis have also mentioned that. If you believe in that, I will quote only a simple example. When I was a child, doctors, when I was suffering from fever, doctors were suggesting that don't take bath by cold water. But nowadays, they're telling, when I get fever, they're telling that please take bath by cold water only. See, so if you are believing in quotations, statistical data, and medical things, so please give statistical data. Dr. Zakir Naik mentioned survey of America regarding coronary heart disease. So do you have any statistical data regarding coronary heart disease in India, whether is affected to more susceptible to those who are having diet, vegetarian diet, or to non-vegetarian diet?
I would request you all to put your question briefly, please.
Your question is so long that one forgets.
Question, last part is the question.
Coronary heart disease is asked.
See, regarding coronary heart disease, plants also, if you consume the decayed the decayed fruits, definitely it will carry germs. The point here is that the animals that carry the germs, they are more dangerous and they are likely to carry more diseases than plant. Another thing is that which I have said is that animal food contains excessive protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. So these two things combined that will make non-veg food prohibitive. Coming to the statistics, I have got that book. There is no time, there is not a platform to argue about the statistics. I have got complete statistics that more people are suffering because of heart disease, those who are flesh eaters, than the veg people. Now, at the moment, I cannot give you those facts and figures that I have got it, then I can supply it to you later. Thank you.
No counter question, please. Yes, the next question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. Brother, my name is Safia. I'm a revert to Islam. My question is, in the book Vegetarian or Non-Vegetarian, Choose for Yourself by Gopinath Agarwal, there are quotations given from major world religions, including Hinduism and Christianity, that non-vegetarian is forbidden, prohibited. And how do you say it's permitted?
The sister is asking the question that there are quotations from the same book, quoting various major world religions like Christianity and Hinduism, saying that in that religion it is prohibited. So how come I said that there is not a single major religion which says that non-veg food in general is prohibited? I clarified the Islamic viewpoint. It's a misquotation, out of context, misunderstanding. I do agree one thing, that there are certain quotations, sometimes non-veg food is prohibited, even in Islam. Like, for example, the verse I quoted, Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse number 1, it says that don't do hunting in pilgrimage. Within the sacred pilgrimage, don't do hunting. If you are fasting in the month of Ramzan, sunrise to sunset, don't have non-veg food, don't even have veg food. If I say don't have non-veg food during fasting, that doesn't mean non-veg food is prohibited. Prohibited only during that time. So similarly, there are quotations in the religious scriptures. At certain time in fasting, don't have non-veg food. Regarding the question in Christianity, and I've read that book, therefore I can reply. They say that in the Bible it is mentioned that you can't have dead food. In brackets, they put meat. It's not there. What they're quoting, the reference is not given. I, being a student of comparative religion, I give talks on diets also. And they're referring to the book of Leviticus, chapter number 17, verse number 15, as well as the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 21. It says that thou shalt not have the meat that dieth of itself. Dead meat is prohibited. Not all meat. Dead meat. They say dead food and bracket meat. It is dead meat is prohibited. Even in the Quran, Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 173, Surah Maida chapter 5 verse number 3, Surah Anam chapter 6 verse 145, Surah Nahl chapter 16 verse 115, Hurrimat alaykumul maitutu waddamu walahmul khinzir, wama uhilla li ghairi allah bih. Forbidden for you for food, dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah has been invoked. Where it is allowed? If you read the book of Genesis, chapter number 9, verse number 2 and 3, it says that they will fear you They will dread you, all creatures of the earth, all fowls in the sky, all creatures that liveth on the earth, as well as all the fish in the sea. They shall be delivered to you. Next verse, Genesis chapter 9, verse 3, says that every creature that moveth on land and is a living creature, they are meat unto you, and also herbs and shrubs. Mention the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 9, that ye shall have the meat of all the things in the water. All that has fins and scales you shall eat. Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 11 says that you shall have the lawful meat of the birds. Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 20 says that ye shall eat the meat of the lawful fowls. It's allowed. Further, if you read, it's mentioned in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 5, verse number 13 and 14, that if you have milk, you are weak. If you have strong meat, you're powerful in reasoning. Bible says that, not I. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 24, only quotation, verse number 41 to 43, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, goes in the upper room, and he says, have you any meat to eat? And the disciples gave him a piece of broiled fish and honeycomb, fish, and he ate before them. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. In the book of Romans, chapter number 14, verse number 2 and 3, it says that one who believeth in eating all things, he can eat. Those who are weak, they only eat herbs and shrubs. But anyone who eateth should not insult those who eateth not. And those who eateth not should not judge those who eateth. This is law of God. Hindu scriptures. If you read the law of Manu, chapter number 5, verse number 30, it's clearly mentioned that the eater can eat any creature that lives, even if he eats every day. A creator created some creatures to eat and some to be eaten. Laws of Manu, Manu Smriti, chapter number 5, verse number 31. It says that if you eat in a sacrifice, this is the law of a god. Manu Smriti, chapter number 5, verse number 42. It says that a twice born
Yes. Brother, no, please.
I'm always prepared when I quote scriptures. Therefore, it's not on the table, it's inside. I wasn't supposed to quote unless compelled otherwise. Now they're compelling me to answer. Therefore, I kept it behind. Otherwise, my books are in the front always. They're compelling me to reply. Therefore, I'm replying. It's within the rules of the debate. I haven't completed it. I have to speak for 5 minutes. What?
We would request anyone not to disturb in between.
Yes, please don't disturb.
The question.
We'll and you can say, who's disturbing? See,
we'll when allow I speak another 20 seconds, you know, because this wastes time, you know, and then my time is up, I will stop the speaker.
No, but someone disturbs me, I should get more time.
Achha, okay, we give. Complete the answer in 30 seconds.
It's further mentioned in the Manu Smriti, chapter number 5, verse number 35, you can have meat. In Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 16, verse number 10, you can have meat. Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 85, verse number 13. Rigved, book number 10, hymn number 86, verse number 13, says the same thing. You can have meat in Mahabharat, Anushasan Parv, chapter 88. If you read, Bhishma gives the advice to Yudhishthir. It's also mentioned in Manu Smriti, chapter number 3, verse number 266 to 272. It's mentioned there that if you want to please your ancestors, if you give herbs and shrubs, you will gratify them only for 1 month. If you give fish, for 2 months. If you give venison, the flesh of deer, for 3 months. If you give mutton, for 4 months. If you give flesh of birds, for 5 months. If you give goat meat, for 6 months. If you give spotted deer, for 7 months. If you give meat of black antelope, for 8 months. If you give cow, 1 full year. If you give bull, it is 12 years. And if you give rhinoceros and red meat of goat, forever, inexhaustible. So if you have to satisfy your ancestors, according to Rigved, you have to give more, you have to give red meat.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Gulfam, and this question goes to Mr. Zaveri. Sir, in your dialogue, you said, Jain Munis don't kill plants, they ask for alms. So is it that they force others to kill plants for them? Or is it that when they put masks on their face, they are not killing the germs and others are killing the germs by not putting the mask on the face? What is it? Please clarify.
It's a very good question, sister. I am really very happy. Of all the questions, I would definitely give you first number, because it is said in Jain religion that you should not kill anybody, you should not allow anybody to kill, and you should not appreciate if one kills. So all these three things are there. So if a Jain Muni comes to know that this food is prepared for him, he will not take it. So this is the rule of Jain Muni. When they come to us for begging, they ask us very clearly, we also know that they will ask us, have you prepared anything for us? We have to very honestly say, we have not prepared anything, it is for us. We have prepared, say, four chapatis, he will take only one, we will be happy with three. This is the way of begging of a Jain Muni. He will not kill, he will not allow others to kill, he will not propagate killing, he will not even eat. If he comes to know that this food is prepared for a Jain Muni, I am happy that in this august and enlightened audience, I have been given an opportunity to clear the viewpoints of Jain Muni. Thank you very much, and I will now request coordinator that Mr. Trivedi and myself, it is really going on so nicely that we would like to continue here for hours together, but I am sorry that time
so
constraint
the
is such.
Last two questions, we'll allow 5 minutes left.
I don't think it will be...
I think we have been talking so much about vegetarian food and non-vegetarian food, but we are all hungry now. I think we should go and eat. So only last two questions and then we disperse.
Mr. Trivedi has said we'll allow last two questions on the mic. When can we have the next question for Dr. Zakir? Yes. Acha, there's a request for Mr. For you want to ask question too? No. But they should have to follow. But I think you should have come up in the queue, you know.
Assalamu alaikum. My question for Zakir bhai is, are non-vegetarian food deficient in
nutrition? There is a request from the other speaker. What we will do, but there is a request from the side, allow one or two people to ask questions to Dr. Zakir. What I would suggest, let the speakers, in the time they are available here, let the other two speakers ask questions. Then Mr. Trivedi and Mr. Zaveri can leave. Then I will give the chance so that I'm not unfair to you also, both people. I've told them they wanted to leave, so I have to give them an opportunity to leave. They wanted those two people to ask questions. They can ask Dr. Zakir. Which are the two people, Mr. Zaveri? Mr. Bade and... aap dono ko chance de denge. Then after that, we will carry on. The other two people will be given chance so that I'm not unfair to them. I hope the audience bears with me. For another 10, Mr. Trivedi and Mr. Zaveri would like to leave after that. So let those two people ask question. Acha, we'll allow only... No.
Zaveri is leaving. Let us ask two questions to him and let him hear.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
let us also ask a question.
Okay, yes, agreed. Let those two people ask question which Mr. Zaveri has requested. Mr. Bade, who's Mr. Bade? Acha, one Mr. Bade and that...
Rule.
Will not... Achha, and the other two, they two, we'll allow them to ask two questions to one
by. To Dr. Hussain.
Excuse me, Mr. Zaveri. Okay, now one question for, yes, one question he'll ask, one you'll ask, then I will allow Mr. Zaveri, after you all have finished your two questions, and one minute, after they finish their two questions, you finish your two, I'll allow them to leave. Then the other two who have missed their chance will be given permission. Beyond that, those who are missing because of these two people will be given a chance. Beyond that, I will not allow. Please, we have
Doctor
to complete
Saab,
the program. Yes, sir.
Namaste and Assalamu alaikum.
I have short, brief and to the point.
Dr. Saab.
Sir?
Dr. Saab.
Brief. Kishori, sir?
Yes.
Brief and
my
to the point.
My question is this. I went to see the picture, Khane Khuda.
there was a session of 3 days. So people, Haji Sahab, they were wearing sandalwood. And then besides that, not eating any as a non-meat food, no haircut, nothing, a complete brahmachari or sannyasi. When the picture was over, I asked them, "Bhai, what is this? Those 3 days, complete renunciation, sannyasi, brahmachari." What reply they gave? He said, "Khane khuda tha." Maine kaha, Musliman bhaiyo, sara sansar khane khuda nahi hai. Wohi khane khuda hai.
Bhai sahab, 3 din aap rakhte ho. Aapse question dera, bhai sahab. Bhai sahab, hamare chief guest ko aur hamare speakers ko jana. Please put forward your question.
Sara sansar khane khuda hai. Please reply to me that those 3 days they were offering is khane khuda. What about the whole world is khane khuda? Why the killing should not be stopped everywhere, especially in India? This is my question.
So we will not allow that question. Sir, on the request of the chief guest and the speaker, we will not allow that answer. May we have the...
Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri requested the person to ask a question out of turn. I'm willing to answer. If chairman says no, then I will. I would love to answer if you allow me. Okay. Anyway, I will control the order. Nothing will go wrong.
Okay, we'll allow him, but a short this thing. What was the question? I didn't hear it.
I heard the question. I'm supposed to answer. It's
okay.
A very good question.
Okay, now quickly and a quick answer, then we'll allow the other gentleman.
It's a very good question.
Yes.
It's a very good question. It will not create problems. I believe though you all are vegetarians out here, we aren't that violent. It won't create problems, I take guarantee. I will not say something that will create violence. Yes, I know there are non-veg and veg meats in Ahmedabad and Gujarat and there were riots and all here. As far as I'm concerned, I speak logical, then nothing happened. The brother asked a very good question. He said that he had seen pilgrims going and for 3 days, they didn't have meat. They didn't have meat. It's on Islam. It's on Islam.
Why Islam allows like this? No, he's asked a question.
He's asking a question on Islam. He's not asking on Jainism. What's the problem? Are you so much afraid that the answer will make him a non-veg? He will yet be a veg. No problem. I don't want you to become a non-veg. The brother asked a very good question, that why there don't you have non-veg? It's a misinformation. I've been for Hajj several times. Whoever told you a lie that we don't have non-veg. The rule out there is that in that sacred part, at that time, you cannot kill any animal for hunting. At that time only. But not eating non-veg. I have gone there. I eat non-veg. Who says you can't eat non-veg? Yes, we are dressed up in 2 pieces of unsewn cloth. You know why? Because it's the biggest annual gathering in the world. People come from America, from Canada, from India, from Pakistan, from Indonesia, all dressed up in 2 pieces of unsewn cloth. Identical. You cannot make out the person next to you, whether it's a king or a pauper, for universal brotherhood. Not theoretical, practical. Universal brotherhood. When we offer salah shoulder to shoulder. We eat food, we eat together. We eat even non-veg. Where you got this from, I don't know. Whoever told you, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, he has told you total falsehood. I'm telling you. I've been for Hajj several times. I've been for Umrah. It's totally wrong. And for universal brotherhood, everyone comes there. So that you can make out people from various parts of the world. We have to be one brotherhood. Islamic brotherhood is that all human beings are brothers. And Muslims are brothers in faith.
Yes, brother.
Mr. Zaveri, this question is for you. At the end of your speech, Mr. Zaveri, this question is for you, please.
Yes, put forward your question.
Mr. Zaveri is having his attention there. Mr. Zaveri, this question is for you. At the end of your speech, you have listed 16 points differentiating between the herbivorous animals and the carnivorous animals. Now, I don't feel there is anyone in the audience to know these differences, except that you want to give emphasis on the point that giving the comparisons of herbivorous animals, you want to reflect that we humans should also be herbivorous. That is, we should be vegetarian. This is what I understand. Dr. Zakir has already touched few of the points. Now, Dr. Zakir and Mr. Zaveri, I'm not a medical student by profession. I'm an engineering student. I had biology only up to my 10th standard, and thereafter only I have gathered some knowledge from here and there.
Ask your now, question, please.
Question.
Now, here are the points which I want to get a comment from you is that you have said that pitalin is there in the saliva of the herbivorous animal. It is there in the carnivorous animals, and it is there present in the humans also. Now, you have said that herbivorous animals rotate their jaws while eating. I have never seen a man rotating his jaws.
It's a question of your, if you want to put a question, you are most welcome. It's not a lecture
your
session.
Question, just
we are not here to hear your impressions. If you are, you are most welcome to ask me a question. Ask me a direct question, I will be too willing to give you a reply.
See, my
Mr. Trivedi and myself, we have got other appointments, we will be leaving after this.
You ask your question in 3 to 4 sentences, that's all. Three to four sentences.
What was the need for you to give the differentiation between herbivorous and carnivorous animals? What do you want to emphasize?
Yeah, it is a very natural thing that when I stated that almost all limbs and parts of the body of a human being are very similar to herbivorous animals, it is for the enlightened audience to decide whether you agree with me or not. If you agree, it's well and good. Otherwise, if you don't agree, then also well and good. Who am I to say that you must agree on one point or others? That's okay. Because what I have stated is a scientific fact, which I have got reasons and I have got proof for that. But it is for the audience to see whether it is you are agreeable to that or not. My only point was that by nature, a human being is not only more, but 100%. He is a herbivorous, and by certain circumstances or by some other reasons, he has been made a carnivorous. Now, friends, I must tell you that I'm extremely delighted to be here this morning and sharing our views, and so many misconceptions about Islam is now cleared by our learned Dr. Zakir. We never knew that these things are said in Islam. And for that, I'm extremely thankful to Islam Research Foundation. And I am also thankful to my friend Mr. Salecha Rushab Foundation. And because of the time constraint of Mr. Trivedi and myself, because we have got other engagements, we will take your leave. And again, thank you very much.
Mr. Bade has to ask. Yes, you are Mr. Bade? Yes. No. Well, excuse me. Mr. Bade has been requested specially to be given a chance to ask question. We have honored that request. And he will be given a chance now. After that, Mr. Trivedi, the last question from that side. And then, yes, last question from there. Ladies, I think, are less in number, so we disallow those two questions which were missed out. I hope that would be fair, Mr. Trivedi. Yes, Mr. Bade, then you, and then we finish the session. Yes, Mr.
Hari Om to Hindus.
After we conclude the session, two people will get a chance to hear Dr. Zakir. If you want to hear the answer, and those who want to hear can stay back, others can go. Yes, Mr. Bade.
Hari Om to Hindus, Jai Jinendra to Jains, Salam Walekum to Muslim Bhai.
Walekum Assalam.
Request to Dr. Zakir, I have all the answers of all your 20 questions, but that will not allow. Kindly give me a chance. Any time, you will get the logical answers of all the 20 questions, number one. Now, all the religions they follow the God. God is Almighty. Now that means one should follow His rules also. Now what is given by the God? The rules formed up by the God. एक सीधी सी बात है कि जब भगवान ने हमें जन्म दिया है, तो उन्होंने हमारे लिए कुछ व्यवस्था भी की.
I would apply the same rule I applied to the last speaker.
1 minute.
Put your question in 5 sentences. Assume Dr. Zakir and Mr. Zaveri know the background. Ask your question. 6 sentences, please.
I am asking you the question only. तो भगवान ने हमारे लिए जो भी कुछ दिया है, उन्होंने कुछ rule form करके दिए हैं. जैसे कि हमारे लिए सबसे essential बात है हवा की. Plenty of hawa is available. Abundant hawa is available. उसके बाद पानी रहता है. पानी where you go, पानी is available. Now, another thing is food, which I am coming to the question. The food, Bhagawan has given us the food also. Kashmir mein hai, humare liye Kashmir mein hai, ilake ke mutabik diya hai, Kashmir mein hai, humare liye almonds diye hai, kaju diye hai, badam diye hai, pisti diye hai, jahan ke, wahan, jaruri hai.
One second. राजस्थान में जाओ आपको वहाँ वो टेम्परेचर के मुताबिक आपको खरबूजा मिलेगा तरबूजा मिलेगा यहाँ हमारे लिए वन सेकंड क्वेश्चन आई एम टेलिंग यू यहाँ हमारे लिए हलवा बना के केले पे ऊपर रख दिया और व्हाट एवर इजीली इज अवेलेबल ही हैज गिवन इज प्लेंटी नाउ व्हाट एवर ही हैज गिवन इज प्लेंटी इज चीपर एंड व्हाट एवर ही सेज नो इट इज नॉट टू बी टेकन और इट इज रिस्ट्रिक्टेड शुड बी he has made it costly. So are we following the rule of the God?
Sir, what very is your question good. On this topic?
Very he good.
Understood.
Okay. Very, I've understood the question. Very long question. Very good question. See, I'm in the field. I can make out the question. I'm in the field. Regarding the first part, that you can answer all 20 points. I've got various students in this field. I'll ask one of my students to have a dialogue at IRF. If you want, any time, which date? Next Sunday. Next Sunday. Not me, my student. Next Sunday.
I can answer to anybody.
Next Sunday.
Anybody.
Next Sunday.
Anybody.
Okay, no. Done. Next Sunday you're invited. What's your name? Mr. Brother, your Bade. Name?
Everything will be given.
Mr. Bade will come to IRF at 10:30. Fine. 10:30 morning. Sunday. Same format here. And my student will debate. Anyone. Same topic. His question, that God has provided air, right, water, everything easily available. So why go for things which are uneasily available and costly? Very good question. That you have to point out to Mr. Zaveri. He's telling that vegetables should be transported to Arctic Circle. Vegetables should be transported to deserts. Tell him, I didn't say that. I'm saying if vegetable is available, have vegetable. If animal is available, have the lawful animal. You have to pose that question to him, not to me. Point number one. You should have easily available food as long as it is lawful. We should have expensive food, you told me. It's like I telling a rich person, why are you living in Nariman Point? You know, 1 square feet of land, apartment, Nariman Point, costs 25,000 rupees. Come to Mira Road, only 1,000 rupees per square feet. When the rich man can afford to pay money to buy a good flat, why are you preventing a rich man to buy good food? And non-veg food, in protein, in iron, in various ways, medically, it is superior, it's of higher quality. So if rich man can afford it, why are you stopping? If you can't afford, have vegetables. I'm not stopping you. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you for your enthusiasm. We'll not allow that question. Mr. Zaveri said he would like to, he's exhausted and we respect his views. He would like to leave, so we'll not allow that question, but we'll allow two people here who are to ask questions after Mr. Zaverian leave, because I've promised them. Just no. Yes, Mr. Dhanraj Sarlecha would propose a vote of thanks, after which those who would like to leave may leave, those who would like to hear those two questions and two answers may sit.
One question from the lady's side.
It's not working. Hello?
The meeting would be formally closed. Only two questions
hello?
After the meeting would be allowed.
Hello? Excuse me, this is one last question from the ladies. This is for Dr. Zakir.
After this, just two people and one from the ladies, no one else would be. Four questions.
Hello?
Mr. Tawedi is saying I should be strict. Now the thing is that I am being compassionate. I give chance to two people here. Now everyone is demanding of it. What we allow? Vote of thanks right away. Then four questions. Two here. One there. Then close. That's final. Yes, Mr. Dhanraj Salecha to propose a vote of thanks.
Chief guest Sri YP Trivedi, learned speakers of dialogue, distinguished guests, brothers and sisters. It's really my pleasant duty to offer vote of thanks on behalf of all the three organizations on whose behalf, I thank Sri YP Trivedi to spare his valuable time and grace this occasion as chief guest. I'm really thankful to both the speakers for their most interesting and informative discussion. And above all, I thank you all the participants for participating in the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Now we continue on with the four questions. The chief guest, Mr. Trivedi, Mr. Zaveri, are excused. Those who would like to hear the three or four questions aloud may sit back. We will continue in a minute as the chief guest and the speaker leave. The formal program is closed.
we will have an informal four questions allowed for the audiences, for the four questioners who didn't get a chance because of my interfering and giving the other speaker the chance. Ladies and gentlemen, your attention please. We are starting the sequel question answer session right away. Yes, brother.
My question is, are non-vegetarian food deficient in nutrition?
The brother asked a very good question. That are non-vegetarian food deficient in any nutrient? Yes, they are. It would be wrong on my part to say no. I'm not a fanatic non-vegetarian. It's deficient in carbohydrate, vitamin C. But this is easily available in vegetables. Non-vegetarian vegetables and fruits, they are rich in vitamin C. We can have fruits. But as a normal comparison, a nutritive value, if you analyze the non-veg food, as I mentioned earlier, it contains first-class proteins, high quality, and complete protein. Contains essential fatty acids, even iron. And one of the good foods is egg, which the speaker spoke so much against egg. The egg contains about 6 grams of protein, one large egg. The half of it is the egg white, and the egg white is known as an ideal protein. Ideal protein means a protein by which other proteins are judged. It contains all the essential amino acids in the right quantity. Egg also contains riboflavin, iron, folate, vitamin B12, vitamin D, vitamin E. One of the few only foods which contains vitamin D is egg. Egg is given to people who are sick and are convalescing, who are improving from sickness. You know why? It's easily digested, contains all the requirement. Spoke so much about egg, it has little negative factors also. It's also called as nutrient-dense food because it contains all the essential nutrients in the right quantity without excess of any one particular substance and contains less calorie, contains 70 calories only, one large egg. But there are many foods which contain essential amino acids which are not there in the veg food. In the veg food, what we have to do, if we require all the nutrients, a person can be a veg and get the nutrients. How? By selecting the particular diet. By selecting the vegetables eating, if this vegetable is deficient in one amino acid, have the other vegetable which has it. So if he selectively chooses in the correct balance and monitors it, then he'll be healthy. In non-veg food, just have very non-veg food, and normally you won't be deficient in the nutrients. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, brother.
My name is Babubhai Zaveri. Dr. Zakir Naik mentioned in his speech, he tried to quote authorities, alternative to Dr. Dean Arnish. Dr. Dean Arnish has been a pioneer in the field of research on reversal of heart diseases, and he has now come to be acclaimed as an authority. His contribution to the field has been recognized by the President of the United States by appointing him as an advisor to advise Americans on health matters. It is at the instance of Dr. Arnish that now it has been incorporated in the authoritative medical textbooks that heart disease can be reversed through the diet which has been practiced and preached by Dr. Arnish. This particular diet consists exclusively of vegetarian food. Now, I would like to know from Dr. Zakir Naik, when he has quoted alternative authorities, what he has to say about Dr. Dean Arnish's research, which has cured thousands of patients of coronary disease without bypass surgery.
Brother asked a very good question, very relevant question, to the point. That what do I have to speak about Dr. Arnish, who is very famous. And he has said that the heart disease can be reversed by food which is only vegetarian food. I agree. Does it make non-veg food prohibited? Do you know diabetes mellitus? Brother, diabetes mellitus. You don't require Dr. Arnish to say if a person is suffering from diabetes, severe diabetes mellitus, if he doesn't take non-veg treatment of insulin produced by bovine
by pancreas of cow or of pig or human being, he will die. So if a non-veg food can cure diabetes mellitus, that doesn't make veg food prohibited. I agree with Dr. Karnish. It proves that heart diseases can be prevented or cured by veg diet. I agree. But what Mr. Rashmibhai Zaveri said, Dr. Karnish said, it should be prohibited as a general rule. For heart patient, I agree. People may differ. Many doctors may differ. I agree. But to say because it cures heart disease, non-veg should be prohibited as a general rule, then why isn't America banning non-veg food? Advisor to American government. Why doesn't the government take the advice of Dr. Anish and stop non-veg food? Why? What his research is, if he's authority, he's right. But to quote authority and then say he banned it, I doubt whether Dr. Anish ever banned it. I doubt. I have my doubts. Show me the statement where he says that no human being ever in his life should have any non-veg food. I challenge you. He may say heart patients. There are other authorities I quoted. Dr. William T. Jarvis. Dr. K. Jerry. Several. But I am more pragmatic. I agree with him. It's helpful in curing heart disease, not as a general rule. Hope that answers the question. I'm very clear.
Yes, sister.
This is regarding, since Dr. Zakir is a scientist and a doctor himself, so I would like him to enlighten me on the 15 years of clinical trial on...
I didn't get the question, sir. Can you repeat the question?
15 years of clinical trial at the National Cancer Research Institute at Maryland in USA on this red meat. Red meat causes cancer and all those things. Is it possible for him to enlighten me on this? Thank you.
It's a very good question. The sister said out of 15 years of research in some cancer hospital. Research, again, not fact. There's a difference between research and fact. But I agree with that research also. I've read that research. Whether from cancer hospital or which hospital which she's referring to, I've read several research that it does cause cancer of the colon. Excessive eating of non-veg causes cancer of colon if it doesn't contain diet rich in fiber. If the diet is rich in fiber, however much meat you have, it will not cause cancer. If it's combined with excessive eating of non-veg and lack of fibrous diet, you know, veg food you eat, it can't be digested because the cellulose can't be digested. It remains as fibers, which helps in the motility. Excessive eating of non-veg with not eating fibrous diet causes cancer of colon. But if you have the proper combination, everyone having red meat doesn't have cancer. Excessive eating, Quran says it is haram. So they are going against the Quran. They are bound to get diseased. That doesn't mean non-veg should be prohibited. It should be said, excessive eating of non-veg should be prohibited. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Thank you very much. Jazakallah khairan for being here today and sharing your Sunday morning with us. Inshallah, we'll be in touch with you.